So ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy, the Institute of Global Health Sciences at the University of California, San Francisco, and the Asia-Pacific Leaders Malaria Alliance, APLMA, a warm welcome to all of you for the Asia-Pacific launch of the Lancet Commission report on malaria eradication. It is my pleasure to be your MC this afternoon. I'm Amita Chebbi from the Asia-Pacific Malaria Elimination Network, APMEN. A few housekeeping notes before we begin today's programs. Can I request you to please turn your phones to silent mode? Thank you. So today's program will start with a few opening remarks from the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Government of Singapore, Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan. We have a summary of the Commission's conclusions from the Commission co-chair, and we also have three panel discussions lined up this afternoon. The launch is being live streamed, and we encourage you to tweet about it using the hashtags Malaria Eradication, Lancet Malaria, and End Malaria. We need to get word out about malaria eradication, and we're counting on all of you. I would now like to welcome Professor Kong Yun Foong to the stage. Professor Kong is the Lee Ka-shing Professor in Political Science at the Lee Kuan Yew School.
Good afternoon, Minister Balakrishnan, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy at the National University of Singapore, I would like to bid you a very warm welcome to the Asia-Pacific launch of the Lancet Commission on Malaria Eradication this afternoon. I understand the sun never sets on the Lancet Commission launch, and I'm delighted that the caravan has arrived in Singapore. At the school, we pride ourselves on developing thought leadership, improving standards of governance, and transforming lives. The school seeks to bring sound evidence and a nation perspective into critical policy issues. In that vein, this commission has brought together some extraordinary minds to bear on this unique endeavor. It is clear from the Lancet report that in the short term, the eradication agenda has important and immediate policy implications, not just for the Ministry of Health, but also for ministries of finance, foreign affairs, and also the private sector. It will also have profound implications for the development trajectory of many nations, from the PNG and the Solomon Islands through the Mekong to India and far beyond. Many lives can be saved. Thus far, the story of malaria elimination in the Asia-Pacific presents a fascinating case study of the policy process, a goal promoted by Australia and Vietnam, validated through deep engagement with the region's senior officials, and then given legitimacy by the leaders at successive East Asian summits. The Asia-Pacific Leaders Malaria Alliance, led by Dr. Ben Roth, have played steward in this process. It is really heartening to see the progress made. Zero cases in China and Sri Lanka, and India halving its burden in 2 years. Going forward, it is the sheer ambition of the eradication agenda outlined in the Lancet report that is so compelling. I know this is not without controversy. No public policy debate can escape the dance between the pragmatic and the aspirational. Indeed, policymaking has been described as the art of the possible, and I can see a lot of creative spirit in this room this afternoon. I look forward to learning more, but for now, allow me to call upon Minister Dr. Vivian Balakrishnan to open our meeting. Dr. Balakrishnan.
Thank you, Excellencies, distinguished guest ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here this afternoon for the launch of the Commission We live in a time of historically low malaria prevalence. And you've just heard zero in China, halving the rate in India. And what this means is that it is now tantalizingly close, that we can credibly discuss not only malaria control, but indeed malaria eradication. And this is thanks to the tireless efforts of scientists, clinicians, healthcare workers, policymakers, engineers, and many others over the past 60 years. The WHO estimates that malaria incidence fell by about 37% between the year 2000 to 2015. And malaria mortality rates have also declined by approximately 60% since 2000. As a former clinician myself, and also as a former minister overseeing environment policy, it is clear to me that we should not be lulled into a false sense of complacency by over the challenge posed by malaria. Why do I say that? First, malaria remains a clear, present, and deadly threat to the world. The same WHO data source that I quoted earlier pointed to decreasing malaria incidence also indicates that we have 219 million cases of malaria which occurred worldwide in 2017 and 435,000 malaria deaths globally. These are still big numbers. Second, we are now vulnerable to newer and more resistant strains of malaria. The progress in eliminating malaria has meant that the remaining parasites in circulation have adapted well to this new environment. And this entails serious emerging risks of anti-malarial drug resistance. Third, we live in an ever more interconnected world, and diseases do not respect sovereign borders. The large migratory foreign workforces, the influx of travelers and refugees, adds to the risk. And even countries that are declared malaria-free, like Singapore, we cannot afford to take the status quo for granted. The solution, of course, is not to close borders. This is not possible in this day and age. Rather, I would like to highlight three themes contained in the Commission's recommendations that we need to be more mindful of and to ensure that we do not lose the momentum achieved so far. First, that international collaboration is absolutely crucial. As the Commission highlights, the success in eradication efforts requires actions across the country, regional, and global levels in order to achieve the 2050 goal. It will require close coordination with international institutions, including the WHO and the UN, as well as regional and sub-regional organizations. Singapore is a very small state, with just a tiny city-state. But by definition, we then have to be a believer and a staunch advocate of the United Nations, and indeed all the other international institutions that make up the international rules-based world order. So Singapore is acutely aware of the need for a multilateral approach when we are dealing with complex global challenges like malaria. This is another example of the global commons. Now, apart from malaria, the global commons also includes poverty eradication, climate change, the next pandemic, and if you think about it, by definition, such planetary challenges of the global commons cannot be solved by any country, no matter how big. It requires an all-of-planetary response. The Asia-Pacific Leaders Malaria Alliance you call it APLMA. We really love acronyms in Asia. APLMA has played a crucial role in forging political commitments within the region. It has sustained high-level political attention on this issue at the leaders' level in the East Asia Summit. And being a regular attendee at this summit, I can assure you the leaders faithfully recite their lines. So there is some political impetus. The APLMA has also provided the technical expertise undergirding these discussions. And the Malaria Elimination Roadmap and the Leaders Dashboard are useful open source resources for countries. Another reason for publishing and making it open source is that that level of transparency also puts some domestic political pressure, lights a little fire under the domestic political leaders, because you remember, at the end of the day, in democracies, leaders react to domestic pressure. And nothing achieves that as much as having the figures published. Comparisons, invidious or otherwise, are obvious, and that sets a certain logic in motion. And these studies clearly highlight that eradication strategies can make a difference, particularly when they're fueled by some political imperatives. The second point I want to touch on is on technological innovation. And I'm glad that the Commission has emphasized this point on innovation. Today, human beings are not only living longer, but also staying healthier for longer, and most parts, a larger proportion of our lives. And medical advances have been a major driver for this change. But I should add, I'm always reminded that in fact it is the engineers who's by simply improving water supply and sanitation and improving the quality of the environment that have saved actually far more lives than the physicians like me in the audience. 200 years ago, the average life expectancy was 29. Today, on a global level, we are on average living up to 72. In fact, in Singapore, the life expectancy is now 84 years. If you rewind to the 19th century, the Industrial Revolution provided employment to many, but was also accompanied by many negative externalities: pollution, overcrowding, urban decay, lack of clean water and air. It was a time ripe for medical innovation. For instance, today we take for granted the germ theory by Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch, but in its time, that understanding, that paradigm change was a breakthrough. And it was thanks to the significant advance in microscope technology. The antiseptic theory by Joseph Lister led to cleaner operating theatres, higher survival rates. And then, of course, we had the use of quinine against malaria, and that was the standard treatment until at least the 1920s. Many of our routine surgical procedures and treatments today are really due to advances made in the 19th century. So it is just as important for us to ensure that there are new tools available, diagnostics, drugs, and vector control technologies that will be deployed in this fight against malaria. And I have no doubt that today's panel's discussion will add to this enlightened debate. The third point is on sustained resourcing. Governments all over the world are facing budget constraints, but I believe the Commission has quite rightly addressed the need for sustained resourcing, because this is not one of those campaigns where you can fund it generously one year, pull the rug out the next year, and expect to have a long-term impact. I'm making the argument for you when you face your own ministers for health. According to the WHO, malaria investments need to be doubled to US$6.6 billion in order to achieve the 2030 target of reducing incidence and mortality rates by 90%. This is a fiscal responsibility that multilateral financial institutions, donors, and governments have to collectively bear. And we are mindful that this meeting takes place, I believe, 2 days before the replenishment conference for the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria. And domestic governments need to play a part. The reduction of malaria incidence in Asia Pacific was underpinned by domestic financing. The economic development in our region over the past few decades has meant that countries like Singapore, Malaysia, and China were able to commit sufficient resources to healthcare issues and thereby contribute to the eradication of malaria. Let me just say in closing that the challenges of malaria eradication are not insignificant, but they can also be overcome if we address them collectively. The expertise and technology to eradicate malaria is actually already available in the region. Whether or not we succeed is really a question, a matter of political will. Everything that needs to be invented has been invented. Can we just do it, execute it, implement it, operate it? The Lancet Commission on Malaria Eradication is a clear testament to the value that collective and coordinated technical leadership from 41 researchers all over the world can produce. I'm glad that we have cross-sectional representation here today from the scientific community, industry, domestic government officials for this launch event. I want to congratulate the Lancet Commission, the APLMA, the NUS, for this successful launch, which I believe is the first in Asia. On behalf of Singapore, I just want to say again that we will support these worthy initiatives. We will make this world a healthier place for everyone. Thank you all very much.
Commission on Malaria Eradication for a summary of the Commission's conclusions. Sir Richard.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and let me start with a very warm word of appreciation to Dr. Balakrishnan for joining us here this afternoon and for his inspiring introductory remarks. I think that countries that have foreign ministers with medical backgrounds and Dr. Balakrishnan's grasp of the history of public health and the improvements in public health in Asia and worldwide in recent decades is a fortunate country indeed. So thank you for your leadership, Dr. Balakrishnan. My task is to summarize in the next 30 minutes the content of the report of the Lancet Commission on malaria eradication to prepare the way for the panel discussions and debates that will follow. So I will plunge into that task. So the Commission was formed in 2017, 26 commissioners, and it was charged with considering the feasibility and affordability and merit of malaria eradication rather than just malaria control, to inform global opinion and to identify priority actions to achieve eradication in the next few decades. And the Commission, of course, was very mindful of the history that Dr. Balakrishnan referred to a moment ago, particularly the outstanding progress in the last 20 years. Since the year 2000, the global malaria incidence rates have declined by 36%. The global malaria death rate has declined by an outstanding 60%. And malaria spending has trebled during that period, thanks in large part to the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria, represented here today, And as Dr. Balakrishnan mentioned, a number of people in this room are rushing tonight to get to Lyon in time for breakfast tomorrow morning, where the Global Fund Replenishment Conference will kick off. And a lot hinges on that. But we have not only been reducing malaria cases and deaths worldwide, we have been shrinking the malaria map in a very dramatic way. If we go back to the year 1900, 119 years ago, all those countries in the world would be colored red. Malaria was everywhere. It was a globally endemic disease. And by the year 2000, we were down to 106 countries with malaria, and they're shown in red on that map. But by the time we got to this year, 19 years later, we were down to 83 countries, and the countries in blue on the map had eliminated. And they are remarkable, and they include Sri Lanka, a remarkable achievement, Malaysia, a remarkable achievement, and China. For the first time in 5,000 years, there is no malaria in China. Quite remarkable. Malaysia, also remarkable. Congratulations. Sri Lanka, remarkable. And Timor-Leste now has no local transmission of malaria. These are outstanding achievements. And if we look forward to the end of 2020, we may be down to 76 countries, because a further 7 countries will have eliminated. And in this region, that will include Bhutan. So we're shrinking the malaria map, and we're down from 200 countries 120 years ago to 76 countries at the end of next year, all being well. But we have to remember that not all countries are equal. Many countries have reasonably light burdens of malaria, but 29 countries have more than 100 cases per 1,000 people per year, high transmission. And those countries are shown in black, or very dark blue, on that map. And they're all in Africa with 2 exceptions. We have 2 countries in this region with African levels of malaria transmission. And they are Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands, both making progress, but with a long way to go, and particularly requiring help from other countries in the region to drive down their malaria rates. The other context that the Commission was very mindful of is that we've been here before. In 1955, we launched the Global Malaria Eradication Program, and in 1969, we abandoned it. So we've been here before, we've tried before, and we've failed before. So we looked at that in great detail. During that 55 to 69 eradication effort, there were successes. 16 countries eliminated, including some in this region. And we reduced transmission in many other countries, including many countries in this region. We achieved very little in sub-Saharan Africa, which was largely ignored during this program. And the challenges included lack of political will. Dr. Balakrishnan just mentioned that. Management failures, a lack of adequate scientific tools, resistance in the parasite to the drug used at the time, and a lack of investment. Those are familiar challenges to us today. And those challenges led to a World Health Assembly in Boston in July 1969, in which malaria eradication was abandoned. And we have to remember that history as we now, 50 years later, relaunch an attempt to eradicate. And that abandonment of eradication was followed by resurgence in many parts of the world. Interestingly, in the very days that the World Health Assembly was meeting in Boston, during those very days to declare the abandonment of eradication, this was going on. Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong were walking on the moon on those very days that the WHO abandoned eradication. And I'll return to that remarkable coincidence a bit later in my remarks. But of course, 2019 is not like 50 years earlier, is not like 1996. And no country in the world can be more aware of the dramatic change between 1969 and 2019 the dramatic change in those 50 years. No country can be more aware of that than Singapore. Here is Singapore in 1969, and here is the same photograph in 2019. The world is utterly transformed, and particularly in this part of the world, where poverty has been driven down and per capita incomes have risen dramatically over that 50-year period. And also, of course, in 2019, unlike in 1969, we have 50 years of experience, research, innovation, and investment in malaria control, but also in the eradication of other diseases, such as smallpox, from which we can build and do better. So the Lancet Commission on Malaria Eradication published its report, the fruit of 2 years of work, about 3 weeks ago, and I think everyone has received a copy as they came into the meeting. And I will quickly run through the main conclusions. These are the 41 authors of the report. Quite a few of them are with us today. We met at Downton Abbey, as you can see in the photograph. And some of those authors were the commissioners, the 26 commissioners, some of whom are with us today, and you'll be hearing from them on the panels that follow. The first thing the commission did was model the world in 2050. What will the world look like in 2050 with a kind of a business as usual approach? Where will malaria be and how intense will malaria be in 2050? And we did very sophisticated mathematical modeling, taking into account the impact on malaria of global trends, such as climatic, environmental, and socioeconomic trends, on which there are huge data sets predicting the future scenarios across the world, and also looking at the current malaria interventions and imagining their scale up to a level of 80% coverage. The current interventions being prompt diagnosis and treatment with current drugs and current diagnostics, I emphasize, long-lasting insecticide-treated nets as we know them today. So this is today's technology, not tomorrow's technology, and indoor residual spraying. And we said, what will the world look like with those trends over the period between now and 2050? And firstly, we have to look at what it looks like today in order to make the comparison with 2050. And these are childhood malaria infection rates with Plasmodium falciparum, the most deadly of the malaria parasites, today in 2017, latest data. And the world looks like this. The yellow colors are the worst, the light blue colors are the next worst, and the dark blue colors are the least worst. Today the world looks like this. What would it look like with business as usual in 2050? The answer is that. I'm going to do that again, because that's so dramatic. This is no new technology, no improved management. This is doing what we do today at higher coverage and the impact of global trends. Today, the world looks like this. In 2050, the world looks like this. Scattered foci of malaria in Africa, only in Africa, scattered foci of malaria with very low prevalences, 95% of the previously endemic areas having a prevalence rate of less than 0.5%. So very low prevalence rate in very low prevalence rates in scattered foci almost entirely in Africa. And we looked at the same comparison between today and 2050 using another metric dearly loved by epidemiologists, the RC, the basic case reproductive rate under control, the number of secondary cases that arise from every primary case. So if I have malaria, how many people will get malaria caused by mosquitoes that have bitten me? And that measures the intensity of transmission of a disease, including malaria. And here we see this reproductive rate in 2017, and here we see it in 2050. Again, scattered foci with very low values of this metric RC. In fact, 99% of previously endemic areas have RC values of below 1.4, And bear in mind that once the reproductive rate falls to below one, the disease will extinguish itself. A disease, an infectious disease, cannot continue to spread unless R is greater than one. So the commission said, well, can we bend the curve? Can we do deliberate, purposeful things to make 2050 not like this, but like that? Can we engineer a 2050 which looks better than the model 2050? And the whole focus of the commission's work was to ask the question, can we engineer a better future, and how would we do that? And the answer is we can, and we can do it in four major ways. And the commission identified four domains with many opportunities for bending the curve, opportunities that can be readily seized and implemented to accelerate malaria decline and create this engineered future of a world with no malaria by 2050. And those four domains we nicknamed software, hardware, finance, and leadership and accountability. Finance and leadership and accountability need no explanation. By software, we mean implementation, execution, the operational dimensions of malaria control, managing the job effectively. By hardware, we mean the science of malaria control, the new tools and technologies. By finance, we obviously mean the money, and by leadership and accountability, we mean leadership and accountability. And just to very quickly summarize some of the main opportunities under those four domains that we identified. Under software, the Commission concluded that management, using data, were absolutely key, neglected, not expensive to implement, and would have huge impacts. And we noted that countries such as China, such as Malaysia, such as Sri Lanka, who make good use of real-time data and have well-managed programs, have eliminated malaria. And Singapore, which eliminated malaria in 1980, and that was not an easy task, made good use of data and had extraordinarily well-managed programs to achieve that. So management and data-driven management we regard it as especially important. We also highlight targeting and tailoring, not spreading your interventions equally everywhere, but targeting and tailoring, incentives, community engagement, implementation research, operational research, learning while doing, and much stronger engagement with the private sector in a variety of ways, which the report sets out. And just to go back to software for a moment, our conclusion that these subjects are neglected, powerful, need far greater emphasis, and are typically either low cost to implement or even cost saving to implement. Hardware, three major conclusions. Smarter use of today's tools. We can do more with the technologies we have today, and we can do better with the technologies we have today, and we know how to do that. Secondly, there are tools on the table that we're still not using. The main malaria parasite in this part of the world is Plasmodium vivax, not Plasmodium falciparum. We have a brand new drug for Plasmodium vivax. It works with a single dose. I take the pill once, and Plasmodium vivax is eliminated from my liver. That's really difficult in terms of the pharmaceutical engineering required. We're not using that drug yet. We've only just discovered it and licensed it. But we will be using it at scale, and it will make a big difference. Another example of a technology waiting to be used. There are a number of other examples that the report sets out. And finally, for the malaria researchers in the room, the development and delivery of new tools and technologies. So the malaria R&D pipeline has never been healthier, whether you look at diagnostics, drugs, other tools and technologies. the R&D pipeline, thanks to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, thanks to the US NIH, thanks to the Wellcome Trust, thanks to researchers and research funders in Singapore and many other places around the world. The R&D pipeline is very healthy, and we are producing new drugs and new diagnostic and other technologies. So tomorrow we will use tomorrow's tools, and they will be better than today's tools. And taken together, that will all have substantial impact. I won't dwell on this, but we spent some time considering the prioritization among R&D targets. You see there data and information technology, diagnostics, drugs, vaccines, insecticides, and finally gene drive, CRISPR and gene drive. And on the vertical axis, you see the likelihood that these technologies will in fact become available. On the horizontal axis, the timeline, the likely timeline to availability, and the size of the bubble, the likely impact on the eradication agenda. So the bigger the bubble, the more important that technology will be. And there's a good deal of big stuff top left, and top left is where you want to be. It's very likely that you're going to get this new technology, and you're going to get it reasonably soon, and because the bubble is big, you're going to have a big impact. So that's a very encouraging diagram and helps us to prioritize our R&D investments, because we're only spending about $800 million a year on malaria R&D, and you can't investigate everything with $800 million a year. You have to prioritize. Coming to finance, and Dr. Balakrishnan touched on this, the Commission produced new estimates of what we're currently spending, and the Commission believes that we're currently spending about $4.3 billion a year worldwide. These are higher than previous estimates for two reasons. One is we expanded the definition of government expenditure on malaria, and secondly, for the first time, we included OOPS, out-of-pocket spending, OOPS, was included for the first time in our estimates of malaria expenditure. And as everyone in the health finance business knows, out-of-pocket spending is a significant proportion of healthcare spending in most countries in the world, except Singapore, and well done Singapore for keeping OOPS so low. But in many countries, OOPS is very high. In India, OOPS is over 80% of total health expenditure. And OOPS for malaria is also too high, and we need to drive it down. And we included those estimates, coming to a total estimate of $4.3 billion. And we call for an additional $2 billion a year. And we call for that to come from two sources, $500 million from aid, from Development Assistance for Health, in other words, international funds, and three quarters of that amount, $1.5 billion, from endemic country governments themselves. And we explore in some detail how those apparently challenging resource mobilization proposals might in fact be achieved. And just to bring this story right up to date, the $500 million per year extra from international sources for malaria, 40% of that is likely to be delivered in 2 days' time in Lyon, France. Because if the Global Fund replenishment is successful, as it seems likely to be, that will put an extra $200 million for malaria alone on the table, 40% of the $500 million that we're seeking. China, in a year or two, is going to have a major celebration of the WHO certification of malaria freedom for the 1.4 billion citizens of China. China may choose to use that occasion to launch a major program of assistance to other countries in Africa and Asia to help them to do what China has done. That will put significant additional funds on the table, and so on and so forth. Other countries are coming forward to add to that pot, and an extra $500 million a year may be very achievable. I won't dwell on this. We discuss in some length financial priorities for the donors. I won't dwell on it. We also look in detail at spending trends from various sources, out-of-pocket spending, government spending, and international assistance. This graph shows the global picture. The picture for Asia-Pacific would look very different, And as part of the follow-up work, we should be producing this kind of analysis on a regional and sub-regional basis. Let me come then to the fourth domain where there are opportunities to bend the curve, opportunities to accelerate progress. Country malaria elimination task forces are something that have worked well in a number of countries, and we recommend them to all countries moving towards national elimination. Regional and sub-regional alliances, we think, are absolutely critical. And we are hosted or co-hosted here today by APLMA and APMEN, the Asia-Pacific Malaria Leaders Alliance, the world's most difficult acronym, and APMEN, the Asia-Pacific Malaria Elimination Network, outstanding examples of regional and sub-regional alliances, which really are driving political commitment and driving technical innovation across Asia-Pacific and accelerating the journey towards a malaria-free Asia-Pacific by 2030, 20 years ahead of the global target. And again, through you, Dr. Balakrishnan, a big thank you to Singapore for being such a welcoming host to this key regional initiative. WHO and the Rollback Malaria Partnership have a number of opportunities to be more coherent in their relationship, to work better together and closer together and more effectively together. The two major sources of international funding, the Global Fund and the President's Malaria Initiative, have also a number of opportunities to have joint investment strategies and to have more impact by sharing policy and sharing strategy and working in a more coordinated way. And finally, we recommend an independent monitoring board to hold all players to account, modeled on the one we have for polio, to try and drive down from very low polio in two or three countries to zero polio over the next few years. The Commission was very interested in the degree of alignment between malaria eradication as a global goal and broader health and social objectives that the world has, some of which Dr. Balakrishnan referred to. And we look particularly at malaria eradication in relation to the Sustainable Development Goals, the SDGs, one of which is universal health coverage. The most important health sector goal under the SDGs is UHC. Global health security, an increasingly a topic of increasing international interest and increasingly attracting international funding. And then, of course, broad economic benefits, of which the primary one is the alleviation of extreme poverty. And the Commission explored in detail the synergy between the malaria eradication agenda and the SDG agenda, the UHC agenda, the global health security agenda, and the and broader economic benefits such as poverty alleviation, and found high levels of synergy, which will be further discussed in one of the panels. So what did we conclude? The key messages of the Commission are shown here. Firstly, malaria can and should be eradicated by 2050. This is the first time that an academic science-based group has reviewed this subject comprehensively and concluded without question among the 41 authors that by 2050 we can get this done. We can eradicate the oldest and most deadly disease of Homo sapiens. Eradication is also affordable. It's a good investment in terms of return on investment, a spectacularly good investment. And the alternative to eradication is uniquely unattractive, uniquely untenable, for reasons described in the Commission's report. So we have to commit to the 2050 goal. Things don't happen unless you commit to them. And in this case, the world has to commit to them, and regional and global organizations have to commit to eradication by 2050. And we have to develop collectively a detailed roadmap between now and 2050, which will show us how to get there. And we need the Asia-Pacific roadmap, and we also need the global roadmap. Now, it's very interesting how the ambition and the leadership in malaria has passed in the last 15 years out of Geneva out of Washington, out of London, and to the capital cities of the endemic countries themselves, and to the regions. It is China that said, we're going to eradicate. It wasn't WHO that rang up China and said, why don't you think of eradicating? It was China that said, we're going to eliminate. It was Sri Lanka that said, we're going to eliminate. It was Malaysia that said, we're going to eliminate. Ambition is coming from the countries and the regions. And the leaders of the countries and the regions have made very bold commitments, as represented by the two Asia-Pacific organizations, and from Africa by ALMA and the Elimination Eight. And the Commission urges that it's time for the bold global commitment, which will support and reinforce those national and regional commitments. And we're very conscious that success follows bold commitments, not vice versa. Bold commitments lead to the achievement of great things. As we saw with smallpox, launched in 66, completed by 1980, and as we're seeing with polio, it has a long tail, no doubt, but we are down to a very few cases in a very few places, so a success. And the greatest example of all time of bold commitments leading to extraordinary outcomes was the speech of President Kennedy in 1961, in which he said, we choose to go to the moon, not because it is easy, but because it is hard, and because it will help us organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. We are willing to accept the challenge, unwilling to postpone, and intend to win. And he said, we will walk on the moon by the end of the decade. And lo and behold, in July 1969, two people walked on the moon at the very time when WHO was abandoning malaria eradication as a global goal. So we need to commit. We need, 50 years on, we need to commit to create a world that looks like this, a 2050 with no malaria on the map at all. And it's clear to me that Asia Pacific is leading this charge and will lead this charge. Japan got the job done in 1961. It wasn't easy. Singapore got the job done in 1980. It was very difficult. There were major outbreaks in Singapore in the early 1970s. Singapore was a building site, and mosquitoes love building sites. There's lots of places to breed. And in a very innovative and unique way, Singapore ended local transmission of malaria by 1980. China did it in 2017. The first year in 5,000 years with no malaria transmission in China. Asia Pacific will do it by 2030 with the work and commitment and leadership of people in this room. Thank you all very much indeed.
Call upon Dr. Ben Rolfe to present on the role of the Asia-Pacific region in delivering global eradication. Ben is CEO of APLMA and is also a commissioner for the Lancet report. Ben.
Well, thanks, Amita, and thank you, Minister. Thank you. And Sir Richard and Vice Dean, hard to follow three incredibly strong and motivating presentations. I can only offer a palate cleanser between that strong first course and the main course of presentations that's coming. I'm going to provide a few thoughts and reflections on the implications of the Commission's report for Asia and bring it back to some of the macro trends, particularly starting with the money. As Richard said, critical to the endeavor. And in 2000, Asia accounted for a third of global GDP. That's on track to be 50% of GDP by 2040, 40% of global consumption. And we've already seen dramatic internal shifts within the superpowers, within this region increasingly moving to a demand-driven, domestic demand-driven economic growth. In fact, the contribution of exports has halved in China, similar picture in India. And Asia will now, very soon in the next few years, become 50% of the global market in luxury goods. 65% of all patents are now registered in Asia. So it is innovation, domestic consumption driving growth. And that should drive public financing, which should drive better health and better education. But despite the rising economies and rising tax revenues, we're seeing a stagnation in investment in public health and primary care. Indonesia's health expenditure is still 3% of GDP, one of the lowest in the world. And the share of total government budget apportioned to health is only 5%, very low. This is replicated throughout much of the region, and the result is that some populations are being left behind. The poor are paying for curative services, often out of pocket, and prevention is neglected. Now, this means, as Richard alluded to, opportunities to invest in the human capital that drives growth are being missed. And we know, in part from previous work led by Richard's group, that for every $1 invested in primary care, $13 are saved from curative services. So we neglect prevention and primary care at our peril. And in Asia, particularly the demographic trends, the health inflationary pressures, mean those dangers are even more acute. But the decisions to neglect or invest in these health priorities in prevention are often politically driven, and health coverage is a vote winner, and we should celebrate that. But at present in parts of Asia, these votes are being won, in some cases, from grand plans focused more on expensive curative services than on prevention. JKN in Indonesia, Ayushman Bharat in India, amazingly claim to cover or aim to cover 180 and 500 million people respectively. I'll say that again, 500 million people covered by Ayushman Bharat eventually. And we need compelling investment cases for services that penetrate to the most poor, neglected, and marginalized communities in our region. And these are very often communities with malaria. And the Lancet Commission is just such an investment case. And certainly for Asia, that's where I see the utility of the Commission is presenting such a compelling case for diverting resources from expensive curative care, often born from out-of-pocket expenditure, which drives people into poverty, and investing in prevention. No country can claim to have achieved universal coverage if they are still plagued by this ancient disease. So the Commission outlines the achievements that we can make with powerful tools we have now and the strong pipeline of tools that are coming. And I often bring this prop, in fact, last time for a meeting with the Minister, a $1 course of treatment and a $1 rapid diagnostic test. This is one of the most cost-effective and simple public health interventions that we have. And a pipeline and a supply of community health workers who can drive those tools down to the last mile, down to communities where they're needed. Despite the challenges in financing prevention, Asia Pacific is already very much ahead of the curve because of these tools. We have halved cases in 10 years. We have doubled financing over 10 years for malaria. And it's no coincidence that we have 23 heads of state driving this agenda. One is very clearly related to the other. Engaging heads of government is critical, and that requires the kind of grand challenges provided by the Commission's work, as Richard quite rightly said. Eradicating a disease is a milestone in the evolution of our civilization, but it is a relatively small ask for a head of government. Heads of government are compelled by evidence such as this, delivered in a very clear and compelling way, with a tangible goal and a clear date. The Asia-Pacific Leaders Malaria Alliance has shown that with modest resourcing, the region can be mobilized to action again, as Richard said. And region by region, the Commission shows we can eradicate malaria. The Commission argues that accountability is critical to success. And the APLMA's Leaders Dashboard, and there are some copies outside, is an example of a mechanism, a tracker, that can hold the region to account, particularly engaging senior officials from central agencies. This is key. Ministries of Health cannot do it alone, and that's one critical bit of learning, I think, from the Asian experience that can be exported globally. The Commission also recommends an independent monitoring board, and this is also critical, an empowered body, an honest broker able to operate outside what is often a very politicized multilateral system. Now, I may not look that honest, but I can assure you that the APLMA Secretariat holding leaders to account, bringing senior officials together, has had a really catalytic impact in driving a sense of achievement, a sense of mutual competition, and a sense of reward when countries achieve these targets. 13 of the countries in this region are now around 10,000 cases or below, and half of those countries are dealing with just handfuls of cases. We are also home to drug-resistant malaria, as you will hear later, and insecticide-resistant mosquitoes. So Asia must eliminate by 2030 if a global eradication agenda is to be credible. We are the first cab off the rank. We're leading the charge. But with a final push, I agree with Sir Richard and others that it is entirely achievable to eliminate malaria from this region by 2030. And it is, in fact, the only way to end this relentless cycle where in this region, often men going out to the forest in poor rural communities, contracting malaria and then bringing it back to the village and through early biting, outdoor biting mosquitoes infecting their children and partners. This can't continue. It's unnecessary when we can address it with a $1 test and a $1 treatment. So anything less than elimination from this region and global eradication is choosing to maintain and pay for a global standing army of health workers, field workers, researchers indefinitely. Impossible. So, finally, let me say this is an invitation-only event. If you are in this room, it means you have a critical role to play in particularly supporting the Asian story for malaria elimination. So I thank you very much in advance for your active attention, but particularly for your active engagement in the sessions to follow. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
So this panel is going to be moderated by Dr. Kamini Mendes. Dr. Kamini has been a leading light in Sri Lanka's successful journey to elimination. She is on the APLMA board of directors and is a tireless champion for malaria eradication in the region. Dr. Kamini.
So would you like the panelists to come now, or shall I give a brief introduction? So very good afternoon to you. As Amita said, we are tackling the challenges through science and research and development in this panel. I would say that if the malaria endemic countries had perfect health systems, and if the parasite and the mosquito did not fight back against the weapons we use, I think we would be able to eradicate malaria or eliminate it from this region with the existing tools. But that is not the case. And so we have to rely on science, research, and development to give us new and improved tools if the goal is to eradicate malaria. Now, we heard in the last few minutes from all of the eminent speakers what great strides this region has made in eliminating malaria or reducing the burden of malaria. But I think we also should keep in mind that this region of the world is also home to the greatest technical challenges that face malaria eradication. It's the home to drug resistance, multi-drug resistance. Every single malaria medicine which fell to resistance started its demise in the Mekong region. The region has forest malaria, which is intractable because mosquitoes that dwell in the forests are not amenable to the vector control tools that we use today. And there is also rampant human migration in the region between countries and into forests. And mobile populations defy all attempts of health systems to provide health care to them. So we have enormous problems, and we look to science and research and development to try and overcome these challenges. To talk about this is an eminent lineup of panelists today. I'd like to call all of them up here. First, I'll give you very brief introductions to our panelists because you have them in your folders, the biodata. First, let me call upon Professor Arian Dondop to come up to the table. Now, Professor, as many of you know, Professor Dondop is the head of the Oxford Mahidol Tropical Medicine Research Unit in Bangkok. He's been working in this region for the past 20 years, and he knows malaria in this region extremely well. He's also the chair of the Regional Artemisinin Initiative, which is the Global Fund's $420 million investment to tackle drug resistance in the Mekong region. Then I have Dr. Caroline Lynch. Would you come up, please, Caroline? Caroline is a malariologist and an epidemiologist. She's worked extensively on Plasmodium vivax. She was a senior lecturer at the London School of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene and is now the representative in the Mekong of Malaria Medicines for Malaria Venture. Then I'd like to ask Professor Balbir Singh to come. Balbir is one of the few experts in the world on Plasmodium knowlesi, which is a malaria parasite of monkeys, which is becoming one of the most daunting challenges to eliminating malaria because this monkey malaria parasite infects humans. And Balbir is the professor, is the head of the Malaria Research Center in the University of Malaysia, Sarawak, where there is a lot of Plasmodium nulsa infections as well. And finally, but not least, Professor Gao Qi, who was at the fore of China's successful, very successful malaria elimination effort. Professor Gao Qi is the director of the Jiangsu Institute of Parasitic Diseases, and he's also currently the chair of the Malaria Expert Committee of China. So with this eminent panel, I'd like to start it off asking the panelists, each of them in that order, to speak a few words, up to 3 minutes each, in each of the areas. And can I ask you, Arian, to start off telling us what's coming from research and development to solve the problem of multi-drug resistance and outdoor transmission?
Yeah, so to pick up upon that first point on anti-malarial drug resistance, so malaria elimination is going very well here in the region, as you said. And there's an additional big incentive to accelerate elimination here in the region because of multi-drug resistant falciparum malaria. Because the drugs that we use, the artemisinin combination therapies, is the only drug that we have at the moment to treat falciparum malaria. And the only way to get rid of resistance that now has emerged against the artemisinin and the partner drugs in the ACTs is to eliminate malaria here from the region. And we won't have new compounds available for the next 4 or 5 years. There are quite a few in the pipeline, very promising ones, but we don't have them for the coming years. So we have to do it with the arsenal we have at the moment. It shows that there are still ACTs that work in certain regions, but countries have to shift from one ACT to the other. Operationally, that is very difficult. We are also trying to combine different ACTs together. They are still very effective, luckily. But our drugs are limited, very limited at the moment. So we have to do it very quickly now, because if we can't treat falciparum malaria properly anymore, then big chance that falciparum malaria will resurge. And also it's good to get rid of the parasites here in the region, because as you said, it's always here where malaria, where drug resistance somehow emerges always. And it's going very well. I think that the main system that has really worked are these networks of village malaria workers, community health workers, to get diagnosis and treatment with high quality RDTs and drugs to the very remote populations. I think the problems that we face in this elimination phase is the drug resistance. As you said, that malaria is retreating in the foresty areas that are difficult to reach, and Vivax malaria is then the remaining parasite that you will discuss further that is more difficult to get rid of because of the liver reservoir that needs a different class of drugs.
Thank you.
Tell us what's in the pipeline, what's new.
I can. Yeah, I'll just start kind of more globally first, relating to the pipeline of antimalarials that Arian spoke about. And as Richard had said earlier, it is looking quite healthy at the moment, even though we have a few years to go for some new ones to come out. But I think it is worth noting that less than 1% of health R&D globally is spent on malaria R&D. So there is scope to widen that envelope, I think, thinking about the future when we have to continue to develop new tools. For Vivax specifically in this region, again, as Richard and Arian have mentioned, it is a significant proportion of malaria cases are due to Vivax, and that's becoming more dominant as countries have become more successful in reducing Plasmodium falciparum. The very exciting new tools in the pipeline, which Richard mentioned earlier on or alluded to, are tofinoquin and the quantitative G6PD test. So tofinoquin is a single dose radical cure for vivax, and the quantitative G6PD test is a test that we can use to decide who should receive tofinoquin or be given primaquine as an alternative. And there's two things in the report actually that I wanted to highlight and to talk about in terms of these new tools. One was about timing and one was about space. So the one about timing was there is a conclusion about accelerating or rapidly deploying new tools. And I think that's certainly something that we should aim to do in order to bend that curve, in order to have the biggest impact with those new tools. But that is a challenging thing to do because, you know, tofinoquin at the moment is moving through those global processes in terms of regulation and policy recommendations. And then it will then have to move through the national regulatory and policy recommendation process. Those can be quite slow events, let's call them. And so in the meantime, we are trying to proactively work with national malaria control programs to help them ready their health systems so that we create a kind of fertile ground for the tools to land into. But that is also a challenging mindset shift of sorts, to think proactively ahead of a WHO recommendation where a lot of countries rely on that recommendation to move forward. And then my last point is really about space, and Arjen spoke about and you spoke about the migrant populations who might not ever come close to a formal health system. When we have these new tools, tofinoquin and quantity G6PD, they introduce a complexity into the treatment algorithm. And I think what we need to do is think very carefully and innovatively about the approaches that we take within perhaps a more flexible health system, like the report also spoke about, and through strong program management and engaging the communities and the private sector to figure out how we can get these new tools quickly and safely to those remote populations.
Okay, thank you, Caroline. So new tools in the pipeline, but a lot of challenges in implementing and using them. Let's get back to that later. Balbir, we have a huge reservoir of noisy malaria in an animal population which is a protected species. Yes. What are we going to do about it?
You said exactly what I was going to say, but never mind anyway. As you heard Sir Richard Feacham say earlier, that Malaysia announced that they had eradicated or eliminated malaria in 2018. However, there were 4,131 hospital admissions due to malaria in Malaysia in 2018. So is malaria elimination in Malaysia fake news? It's not fake news because the WHO definition, when we're talking about elimination and eradication, is human malaria parasites. And the 4,131 cases were all Plasmodium novae. I don't have an answer as to why we should only concentrate on malaria parasites from other humans. At the end of the day, it's humans that are coming down with malaria. Right? So what do we know about novae malaria? The natural hosts are long-tailed and pig-tailed macaque monkeys. Long-tailed macaques are the most common non-human primates in Southeast Asia in this region. Extremely difficult to reach, and you got a huge reservoir. In the small study that we did, 95% of the macaques that we looked at had malaria parasites. Transmission is by mosquitoes that are outdoor feeders. So the current methods that we're using, long-lasting insecticide-treated nets, and indoor residual spraying, that would be largely ineffective against noisy malaria. It's not confined to Malaysia. Every single country in Southeast Asia has reported cases of noisy malaria. What do we do about it? I mean, what should we do about it? I mean, there are a lot of things that we should about it. One of the things that we should do is continued surveillance, definitely. And we should come up with more sensitive molecular detection methods. Cheap detection methods can be used in rural areas. Nested PCRSs obviously are not a viable option, so we have to come up with more sensitive methods and more sensitive rapid diagnostic tests, which we do not have at the moment. And the other thing is, like I said, continuous surveillance, early detection and treatment, because if we stop doing early detection and treatment, there is going to become human-to-human transmission of Nolsey malaria, and it's going to become a human malaria parasite. So that's all I'll say at the moment.
Okay. Thank you very much, Balbi. Professor Gauchi, so China has about a year to go to apply for certification of elimination. And can we ask you, China has a major role to play as leaders in this entire region to share your expertise and help the other countries. Could you tell us the plans?
Okay. Within the 3 minutes, I just talk about two stories to show the malaria elimination in China. So first, when we plan to elimination, this is in 2006-2008. During that period, we have a rule, what we can do. We have two choices. One is continue to what we done at before. But the challenge is due to we from 30 million cases per year reduced to about 20,000 per year. So if we continue it, the government, the public, there will be reduced the political support and the financial support. You should be like always like this one. When the money drop down, malaria turn up. So when money increased, so always like this, we lose the chance. So in this way, we have to make the political pay more attention to the malaria. Only we need a new policy, so malaria elimination. So that time, we do this. Second is during that period, we didn't know how to do malaria elimination. So we select 6 provinces, 12 counties to the pilot test how to do for malaria. We want to do everything what we done in control phase, strengthen everything. We want to say this can be elimination. Finally, they reach the goal, but the cost effective is very high. So we need a lot of the money. At the beginning, we supported by the global fund, but finally global fund stopped. So the challenge is without the enough money, how we can do elimination. So this is what we think about from population-based to case-based. So for elimination, we think about how to do. One is find the resource, so find the case. Second, if the case, how to classify this import cases or local infection case. If the local infection case, where is the resource that transmission? So this is the facade. So how to classify elimination and the facade. So finally, we developed the new strategies. Now is the famous thing here is 137. So 137 actually is a case-based surveillance and the response. So we're using this for successful for elimination. The last, more important, is a subnational verification. China is too big. So some province already 10 years, there is no malaria. So how to make sure this no malaria is not due to your no work? You have a surveillance and no case. This is everyone agree. So we through the prevention to prevention, subnational verification. One is make the local government pay more attention to for this. Second, the strengthen ability for surveillance and response. The third is correct the document for national certification. So we plan to, in the end of this year, 24 provinces totally, they have a local transmission, will finish the subnational verification within this year.
Thank you very much to all the panelists for keeping to time, but this is not the end of your speeches. So let me provoke you. So China, if China could eliminate malaria, I think that itself is an incentive for every other country in the region. The size of China, having borders with highly malarious countries right around them, there is really no excuse for other countries not to follow China. So thank you for that. And I think Professor Gauchi is saying this part of the world should now get ready to make the transition from malaria control, which is giving out bed nets, giving out treatment, to transiting into surveillance and response. Now it's a matter, because the burden of malaria is low, So it is surveillance and response, and not just countrywide coverage with bed nets and things like that. So that's enough from me. Now, I'm going to ask Arian, I know you're doing more than what you spoke about. You've tested three drugs together, triple combinations. Are you hopeful that that's something that's in the pipeline?
Yeah, so the idea behind that is that the artemisinin combination therapies combine the rapidly acting artemisinin component that is now much less active because of resistance. And we are now combining it not with one partner drug, but with two partner drugs. We choose them cleverly that we think they have counteracting resistance mechanisms. Yeah. And we have just finished a trial to try them out in around 1,500 patients in the Greater Mekong subregion countries. And they, luckily, are very effective and also safe and well-tolerated. No unexpected interactions except for a few that we are working on. So that could be an approach to at least bridge the coming years before the new compounds become available. And it will also help to stop the further spread of these resistant parasites. So we are quite hopeful with that.
Okay, thank you. Would any one of you like to touch on outdoor transmission? What's new from science? That's a big issue in this part of the world, forest malaria.
What do you mean by
that? I mean, there are no solutions yet?
When I look at Sarawak and Sabah, I'm quite surprised that the cases have come down, human malaria cases, because it's mainly, or they gave out bed nets and they gave out, they did residual spraying, whereas the vectors were known to be outdoor feeders. So I think it's actually mainly due to early detection and treatment. Okay. That's what has worked. And, obviously you need to reduce the number of parasites that are circulating. And the only way you can do that is target a person before he spreads it to other people.
Okay, that's a huge problem.
But I don't know what's new as far as outdoor transmission is concerned. We have to come up with innovative methods to prevent mosquitoes from feeding on people who tend to go to the forest or to the forest fringe. And telling them to apply mosquito repellents on a daily basis, it's impractical, it's expensive. So we need to come up with better methods than that.
So it's reducing the human monkey contact, right? Now that's easier said than done.
No, I'm talking about malaria in general, but as far as monkey malaria is concerned, it's virtually impossible. Yeah. Because, like I said, we've got a huge reservoir of malaria parasites that are untouched. Yeah. And how do you control it? So we have to come up with some innovative ideas. And they are protected species. We can't target the monkeys.
No, we can't. Yep. Absolutely. Caroline, can I challenge you? So we have a great new set of tools for Vivax, staphylococcus single dose. But because of safety issues, you have to be very certain that the quantitative test for G6PD is used. Now, that is a complex health systems challenge, right? We have to eventually get it to the remotest parts of the country. We also have primaquine today, which we don't like because it's a 14-day regimen, but countries have eliminated malaria using primaquine. There are many examples. So, what would you say? You think we can get it down to the most peripheral level of the health systems where it's needed?
I think that's the question, really, as to whether we can. And it requires quite good implementation research to figure that out with national malaria control programs and partners. I think in terms of PQ, we don't just have PQ14. There is another option coming up for... Yes. NMCPs, and that's PQ7.
7 days.
And I think, you know, this is the first time that we've had a few options for Vivax on the table, which puts us at more of an advantage than we were previously. And PQ7 offers, perhaps combined with TQ at some levels of the health system, a way forward as well. So I would say, optimistically, yes, we can get it down there, but we do need to think a little bit outside the box as to how to get it down there safely.
Okay. I'd like to open the discussion to the floor.
I think we've spoken enough, and I'm sure many of you will have comments and questions. And also, please feel free to comment on the recommendations of the Lancet Commission's report on R&D. Sir Richard put up a slide showing the R&D pipeline. Is it, what do you think? Is it hopeful? Is it a wish list? Is it realistic? Any kind of comments? Over to you. Let's see. Yes, please. And please introduce yourselves in case.
Hi, Jesumut Bajamsi from Mahidol University, Thailand. First, come in for the commission because I was in another commission launch in London, and I think I totally agree for the frame and everything, but the detail of R&D still be the challenge for a lot of researchers. So the first question go to Arin. Typical therapy, some of the ACT combination already success in the trial but fail fast in certain area like Cambodia before. Do you expect that the triple drugs will also prolong the resistance of the parasite, or what do you think?
So to answer that, I have to be a bit more specific on the triple therapies that we are testing. We have tested two separate ones. One is DHA piperaquine plus mefloquine, and the other one is artemether lumefantrine plus amodiaquine. That first one, DHA piperaquine mefloquine, we were hoping that those resistance mechanisms were counteracting each other, because when we started, we hadn't found any parasite that was resistant to both at the same time. Over time, however, there have been found a few parasites that carry the resistant genes for both, against both those drugs. And since there's a high level piperaquine resistance now in Cambodia, artemisinin resistance is there. If you're not sure about the mefloquine, probably that's not the most ideal triple combination for the Cambodian situation. So the other triple, artemether lumefantrine, amodiaquine, there we have stronger evidence that indeed the resistance mechanisms are counteracting each other. So that would probably be the preferred triple therapy if Cambodia has to introduce this approach.
Yes, we used to have in Thailand segment of different area because the resistance doesn't happen all throughout the country. So I just wonder if this could be like local perspective of which area should be used for a certain drug. Maybe that another option that we can slow down the resistance instead of everywhere use the same. The second question go to Caroline Tefanuquine. Is that possible because it's long half-life drug, right? I just wonder because in the Asia it's between 7 to some area over 20% G6PD. So that very challenge, even we have a very good drug. Is that possible to make even lower dose of tefanoquine? I know it's very low dose already, but then you know, like primaquine, we can use primaquine to treat G6PD people by give less frequent instead of daily. It can be weekly. Faculty of Tropical Medicine tried that and it worked well, right? But then if it lower dose, possible, that number one. Number two, tefanoquine itself is also kill the asexual form, not only the hypnozoid, right? So I just wonder whether higher dose or lower dose, because if it lower dose, we know that in Asia, the relapse is 30 days. If the lower dose, less toxic to G6PD, can maintain longer 30 days, so its impact to the hypnozoid that come out.
Yeah. I mean, I think they're quite key questions. I think at the moment, we still have ongoing studies alongside the current dose that that's been approved by TGA and FDA. In terms of a lower dose, I think the dosing range studies that GSK have done kind of guided them as to the dose that's been chosen. And I wonder in the region whether it might be a bit risky to go for a lower dose, just given the relapse rate and the refractoriness of some of the Vivax strains. In terms of the asexual form, what was your question?
Stage. Right?
So are you talking about it as a transmission blocker?
Not really. We just kill whatever left over from the hypnocyte if you use the lower dose. That's what I mean, because the relapse normally occur less than 30 days if you don't treat hypnocyte in the tropical strain, except the Chinese strain, which Dr. Gao should already eliminate from China, I hope. That take longer time.
So you're saying that will tofenaquin?
Yeah, with the lower dose, if the dose still impact the blood state, right? So you won't see, it will still block the transmission anyway.
I think that's probably going to be investigated at some stage soon, the transmission blocking part of, or role of tofenaquin. Probably not in this region though, unfortunately.
Okay, Ken, thank you. Alta, would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, my name is Alta. I have a question for you.
Two-part. Number one, the triple drug combination, we discussed it in the context of GMS. If you can carry over that conversation to African theater, the need, the urgency. And second piece is something that we just had a meeting in Delhi, and the co-chair and I agreed to write to health minister about tofenaquin. That NRA should not wait for months and years and have multiple meetings before they grant the approval. So the question is to you as well, to Sir Richard Feacham, should commission continue its work beyond publication to identify important regulatory hurdles, whether they are drug approvals or insecticide approvals? It takes much longer for an insecticide to go through the regulatory system. Pharmaceuticals are relatively easier. So that question to Sir Richard Feacham, but first to you for triple drug in Africa.
Yes, so we are looking definitely into that at the moment by doing a clinical trial with triples in Africa, but also to sort of probe whether there is enough support if you say, you know, we need to change the paradigm how we treat malaria, especially falciparum malaria, that we should always use three drugs at the same time to not end up in this endless cycle of deploying a drug or a double drug and then resistance, and then you have to move away from that. But there are lots of pros and cons there, because if you use triple therapies whereas the double therapies are still working, you expose children to an extra drug with a bit more side effects, it's a little bit more expensive. So there you can argue against it also. Personally, I think the pros will win, and I think there's much to say to have also industry more motivated to develop triple therapies than only the double therapies. And then there are a lot of regulatory and aspects also that makes that difficult. But as a concept, I think there's much to say in favor of it. And Richard, about continuing the commission work and about the regulatory aspects to try to speed up those processes. The question was to you from Altaf, would you? Mm-hmm.
I'll comment at the end.
Okay.
I think this is fairly the end, Sir Richard. I'm gone over 2 minutes beyond our time limit. Mita has generously allowed us to do that. Would you like to? This is the end of the panel session.
He's summing up at the end.
Oh, at the very end. Okay. So I think with that, let me thank the panelists very much for your contribution.
Thank you.
Institute, where he focuses on innovation in healthcare financing. Christoph also serves as the part-time senior advisor at the Global Fund and is on the APLMA board of directors as well. Can I also invite all the other panelists to the podium, please?
Thank you very much, Amita, for that kind introduction. And before I will introduce our eminent panel, allow me to make one personal comment. I started my own professional career more than 30 years ago as a young physician in East Africa, fighting malaria. And malaria was a devastating disease, completely out of control. And apart from chloroquine and quinine, we had basically no tools to fight that disease, not even mosquito nets in the communities. And not in my wildest dreams would I ever have thought that I would see the day when we can credibly talk about the eradication of malaria. So I think this is a huge achievement that we all have to be conscious of. What is it that we are talking about here today? And how unusual is it that we would ever be in a position to talk about this level of ambition that is achievable and necessary? So also, thank you so much, Sir Richard, all the commissioners, but basically everybody who has helped us to get to this day that we can discuss that. So the role of our panel is to talk about financing and the multi-sectoral approach. Just a couple of introductory remarks. You know, Richard mentioned that there are a couple of domains that we need to really achieve this goal of eradicating malaria by 2050. Financing is one of them. And the Commission made it very clear that we need roughly $4 billion additionally per year if we want to achieve this goal. And out of this four, there was the kind of, $2 billion per year required additionally, $1.5 billion from domestic sources, and $500 million annually from international funding. And out of that, the report specifically referred to the Global Fund as one of the main multilateral funders, and saying we will need $200 million additional per year from the Global Fund, and you referred to the upcoming replenishment. And I will be one of those who will leave immediately after this session to go to Lyon, to be on time for the official opening of the replenishment meeting tomorrow. And while the outcome of this replenishment effort for AIDS, tuberculosis, malaria for the next 3 years will be announced by President Macron on Thursday morning, I dare to make a projection here. First of all, because more than 80% of the pledges are already public. Most donors have actually announced their pledges, publicly before the replenishment. And secondly, because I've been quite closely involved in that process. So I dare to project that the Global Fund will get pretty close to the $14 billion that was announced as the goal in the investment case of the Global Fund announced in India earlier this year, which will be quite an achievement in this political environment, because it will represent exactly 15% increase over the previous period. So that will take us a long way towards this kind of additional $200 million per year. But as the report says as well, we need at least $300 million from international sources. And it recommends that we should be looking at new donors and smaller donors. And that's exactly where I would like to raise one word of caution. Because if you will be looking at where the roughly $14 billion will have come from 2 days from now, you will see that even more than before, those resources will come from the major donors, particularly from the G7. So rather than a broadening of the donor base, we will see a further concentration of the donor base. So that's very welcome that there has been such a huge commitment from the G7. But at the same time, it's a bit of a worrying trend that we need to watch carefully, as we are here in the long haul for financing the fight to eradicate malaria. And we will need new and smaller donors to come on board if we want to achieve our goals. And that will not happen automatically. These decisions about allocating budgets for any disease control, like malaria, you know, are decisions that politicians have to make. And politicians have many competing causes, and they need to be informed about why they should make these decisions. And therefore, we should be aware that we need also to invest in that process to kind of keep informing decision makers all around the world, actually, that malaria eradication is possible and needs to be achieved, particularly at a time when malaria as a disease will become less and less visible. You know, as we see, you know, morbidity and mortality coming down, it will be up to many of us here and many others to advocate that this is a fantastic investment that needs to be made. So, bit of good news, but also a little bit of a word of caution that we should discuss maybe also how can we achieve that to make sure that malaria will be financed in the long run. But with that, I would like to introduce really an outstanding panel that we have to discuss these questions of financing, partnerships, and the multi-sectoral approach. And I have the rare privilege to moderate my moderator. So our first speaker will be Amita Chebbi, who is actually the senior director of ABMEN, and the Asia-Pacific Malaria Elimination Network has been mentioned several times today as one of the co-hosts of this session and our moderator. So Amita, you will be the first speakers, and I introduce the others after your first contribution.
Thanks, Christoph. So I'm going to focus a bit on the multi-sectoral approaches, part of our topic, and share a few thoughts. So Confucius says, when we walk together with three people, one of them will have something to teach us. And I think this is particularly true for any multi-sectoral collaborative platform. Now, the Sustainable Development Goals really provided an impetus to countries to focus on multi-sectoral approaches to get to their health targets. The recent UN General Assembly, for instance, and the focus on universal health coverage there has really put the spotlight back on partnerships and multi-sectoral collaboration. And we see that the conversation now is really around integrated health service delivery, and not just with different health areas. So it's no longer just about collaboration between maternal and child health, sexual and reproductive health, you know, your infectious diseases, HIV, TB, malaria, your NCDs, but really beyond health as well. You know, what is it we can learn and do with sectors like water and sanitation, education, agriculture? So it's been really good to see this change. This idea of multi-sectoral collaboration has really found resonance in the Lancet Commission report as well. The report has really highlighted the benefits and the efficiencies that accrue to national malaria programs with integration into general health systems. Now, we know that multi-sectoral action does not occur passively. It requires investment, it requires active effort, and it requires constant attention. I think here in Asia Pacific, we're very fortunate to actually have two platforms that focus exclusively on this idea of multi-sectoral collaboration. So I represent the Asia Pacific Malaria Elimination Network. This is an organization that was set up 10 years ago to bring together different stakeholders that work on the issue of malaria elimination. Today we have a membership of almost 75 members spanning actors from academia, research, implementing organizations, funding institutions, national malaria control programs, of course, as well as the private sector. Our sister organization, the Asia Pacific Leaders Malaria Alliance, is also another regional initiative, and they focus on the policy, advocacy, and financing solutions for malaria elimination. So between the two of us, I think we provide a lot of opportunities for collaborative action in the region. Now, our experience with running these platforms has shown that multi-sectoral collaboration has to be a managed process. It doesn't happen by chance. It requires, like I said, active effort. And particularly if the goal is to work towards some shared outcomes, then we need to have a better understanding of the different incentives that drive various partners that form part of the network. We need to have an understanding of the different contributions that each partner can bring to the network. And most importantly, there needs to be very active communication and engagement between diverse partners to get to a common goal. So I'm just going to end here and say that, you know, when I heard this saying by Confucius, what struck me was that Confucius didn't say, what should we do with the other two guys whom we're not learning anything from? But I think that's a conversation for a different time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Amita. Thank you for introducing these two very important networks here in the region that are really critical to drive this effort forward. Our next speaker, Dr. Jimmy Rogers, needs basically no introduction here in this region, I think. Jimmy, you've you know, had so many roles in this region, both in, you know, Solomon Islands in the government there, regionally in the Asia Pacific community, and also long time as a vice chair of APLMA. So you've been looking at this from many different perspectives, but you can share with us also what needs to happen to really engage at the national and at the regional level to eradicate malaria from this region.
Thank you. This might work. Okay. Yeah. All right. So, brevity is what I liked about the Commission's report. And four key phrases. You can eradicate. It's affordable. It's good investment. Nothing else stands up. And I think those are key messages, that the punchlines that will be needed to eradicate malaria. So I think going forward, I just want to share thinking beyond the money. Now, if you look at the balance sheet, the current spend is about 4.3 billion. We need about 6.6. We start from a deficit, right? So it doesn't look good. But if you look at the balance sheet of aspiration, vision, and commitment, it outweighs the deficit. And I think that's something that will come in. And that will be a combination of money, but also a combination of human resource that can be transformed and translated into what would be money for countries like Solomon's. So when I look at these billions and millions, I sit there and I say the total national budget of the Solomon's supporting the whole country is about $420 million. So when we look at the eradication from the perspective that that's all the money the country has, it becomes a difficult ask, where else would money come from to try and help us eradicate malaria? So we've got to think laterally. And thinking laterally is really looking into mechanisms of multi-sectoral cooperation. And two key things I think we've discovered. One is the role of political leadership that is genuine, and it's not for buying votes because it happens every 4 years. But the other is the role of managing the resource that you have. Then put into that is identifying at the national level who the strategic partners are nationally. So in countries, small island Pacific states, where populations range from 50 in Tokelau to a few million in Papua New Guinea, they come in different shapes and sizes. But the key actors are government ministries, private sector, churches, civil society, and women organizations, youth organizations. These are the forefront. And the question for us is, how do we empower that group to be the army that will be part of eliminating malaria? And it's not about how much money we give them. It is more about how do we create an environment that empowers them, that allow them to take up the fight and clean up their own yards, clean up the drains, reduce transmission sites, reduce mosquito population, therefore reduce parasite transmission. So I guess multi-sectoral cooperation for us is more about how do we innovate. And when we innovate enough people, translating that becomes something that supplements the resources. Make no mistake, we need the money. But if we can't get to the target that we want, the only other thing we can have is to innovate, empower the human resource, and give them the role that there's something in there for them. And that's the focus now that we have. The other part that we need to look at is it's not very easy to cooperate, even within one single government entity. And therefore, sector ministries like health, who are the lead in trying to eradicate malaria, I'm fairly low in the pecking order of being able to get the other ministries in. So the convening authority needs to be decided. Who has the convening authority in the country? And for the past year, that's now shifted to the Office of the Prime Minister and Cabinet. And that way we have been able to get Cabinet support for roadmap to eliminate malaria. We're now developing a strategy, and we are convening a whole of government and whole of society, including private sector and churches, so that they actually know that they have a part to play. And when they know that this is their work, rather than they are being tasked from outside, it becomes a different ballgame. So although we are one of the two countries in the Pacific with Africa proportions in that, we are fairly confident that 2030 would be malaria free. And so that is the target that we have going forward. One final point, I think, is how do we also make use of international partners that are genuinely interested to come and support? The key thing is they need to buy into the national plan. There is one plan, one financing mechanism, one implementation, monitoring framework. But there are partners who don't give us money, but they give us human resources to help us in our coordination of efforts in the country. And we are working with them because translate this technical assistance into dollar sources, it will still become a lot more if you were to convert it into financial terms. So I guess for me, it's all the question of having all the money is important, but if we cannot have all the money, how do we empower and innovate and get every people to own that it is their business for their health, their future, and their own investment for future generations to be counted the generation that have eradicated malaria. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jimmy. Our next speaker is Robin Davis. Robin is the head of the Indo-Pacific Center for Health Security in Australia and representing here on the panel and I think also in the audience, the major bilateral partners as well. And Australia, you know, being of course a close partner to many countries in the region. How do you see the contribution of a country like Australia to, you know, help achieve the goal of eradicating malaria in this Asia-Pacific region?
Yeah, thanks, Christoph. I might say a little bit about financing and a little bit about multi-sectoral collaboration, but I want to make a similar point in relation to both from an Australian perspective. So I remember around, I guess it was early 2018, when Peter Sands spoke at the Prince Mahidol Awards Conference. At a time when I guess the global policy framework, the global health policy framework was really crystallizing. We have a commitment to universal health coverage, and then on the flip side of the coin, as Dr. Tedros often says, we have health security. And Peter Sands in his speech appeared to be saying, great, but don't forget about the big endemic diseases. And that was how his speech was interpreted by many. But I sort of read it the other way as well. I think he was making two points. That those of us focused on the control and elimination of those diseases should also look to health security financing as a new well to be tapped. And I say that because Australia, just before that conference, had announced a regional health security initiative, which in a sense does what Peter Sands was looking for. The focus, as initially conceived, was quite strongly on emerging infectious disease detection and control. And of course, this came out of the global experience with the West Africa Ebola crisis. But very quickly, as this initiative unfolded, and as we undertook consultations with partner governments in the region, its remit expanded so that it was focused on both endemic and emerging infectious diseases. You can't walk through the door of a health minister's office and say, I want to talk to you about the possibility of Ebola or a resurgence of SARS. They want to talk to you about their most pressing problems, but at the same time, they're very happy to talk about how assistance for those better equips them to deal with other emerging threats. And that's very much the kind of conceptual basis of Australia's health security initiative. And you can see that now, a couple of years down the track, in the fact that we are a strong supporter of APLMA and APMEN. We have just renewed our funding relationships with those regional bodies. And we have, we're on the verge of announcing a number of country and multi-country activities that bear very strongly on malaria surveillance and outbreak response. On the wider scale, we participate in a global process, the Global Health Security Agenda process, which was originally kicked off by the United States and then multilateralized or plurilateralized. And we find in that process the lesson has perhaps not yet been learned. That's a process where most of the discussion is about emerging infectious diseases. And there is not a sufficient focus on HIV/AIDS, TB, and malaria. And in that context, we're trying very hard to make, I guess, the point that Peter Sands made to us all in early 2018, that you have to focus on the full suite of threats. So the message there is, I think there are funding opportunities in the health security domain that can increasingly be tapped into by the malaria elimination community. Then more briefly on the point about multi-sectoral collaboration, again, in the health security world, where you're not talking about specific diseases, there's of course a very strong focus on the international health regulations and countries' capacities to meet the international health regulations. This comes very much out of the experience with severe acute respiratory syndrome in the 2003 period, a disease which of course hit Singapore quite hard. And there's a whole monitoring and evaluation framework, a whole capacity building agenda around the international health regulations. And as part of that, there's also a very heavy emphasis on multi-sectoral collaboration at the country level. For example, one of the things that you're starting to see in many countries is the conduct of so-called national bridging workshops, which bring together health ministries and agriculture ministries, but also increasingly finance and environment ministries, to focus on how to prevent, detect, and respond to emerging infectious disease threats and endemic diseases. Now, I think this is a process that, again, it doesn't sufficiently engage national malaria control programs, and is not seized upon as it could be to reinforce regional malaria elimination objectives. So it's kind of a similar point. There are two worlds here that I think can slowly come closer together. We still need disease-specific initiatives and funding drives, but there are new opportunities in the health security financing domain.
Thank you. And our last panelist, Dr. Altaf Lal. Altaf, you have played many different roles over many years in malaria control. As a scientist, you are now a senior advisor to Sun Pharma in India. You are also on the board of APLMA, and you've been a commissioner. So you've been involved in every aspect, if you like, of malaria. But you are here also the only one who's coming from the private sector, if you like. Yeah. Can you comment a little bit, you know, how you see the particular contribution of the private sector in getting us to the goal?
Well, thank you so much. I'm going to take a minute. You described your beginning in malaria from work in Africa. My start in malaria was from eighth grade. In eighth grade, I had a question about malaria, which I flunked. Then I read after the exam. Then I had a question about malaria every year from that year onward. So I think in many ways, I find it very interesting that I'm concluding my life working on malaria still. I tell people it's a beautiful disease. The people who work on malaria are beautiful people. They're thoughtful people. We export malaria wisdom to HIV/AIDS. We exported it to TB research. But over the last 5-6 years, I have seen the private sector up close. I serve on the board of APLMA, I serve on the board of RBM. So I see the global and the national discourse and conversations that happen around financing point of view. Those of you who work at this school and are from Singapore, you know the background of how the school got started. Right, $150,000 in 1920s given by two gentlemen, Mr. Mayer and Mr. Ham. So whether it's the private sector or public sector, they need convincing that there's a need.
you have to show them that you're capable of converting that need into a product, and that you have systems to monitor it. I'm guided by a comment the chairman and the managing director of Sun Pharma makes, that I don't have a rupee to waste, but I have millions of dollars to invest in you. So when I first asked him what would he like to do, this is 2014, as his legacy in CSR, he said, give me the toughest project where the chances of failures are significant. But I don't want us to fail because I'm talking to you. So I put malaria elimination in front of him. Sun Pharma had no interest in malaria. They had just acquired Rambaxi, and Arjun knows there was cinereum, anti-malarial, which was not WHO approved, so it wasn't a money-making drug for them. So he was convinced that this is a worthwhile cause, so that's where the need came up. And we knew that for any program at national level to succeed, you need strong program managers. I won't go into whether we have strong program managers or not, but the need was expressed. So whether we raise $100 million or $1 billion, Robin, if there's absence of strong program management, the outcomes will not be what you want. So the commission report identifies the importance and significance of management controls. A disease elimination is a management issue. You put five MBAs around a program manager, you'll get the job done. You put one MBA around him or her, you'll get the job done. Finance minister, and you mentioned, Jimmy, the health minister's capabilities. Finance ministers often have those roles, where do we divvy up? But they rarely talk about or are briefed on health issues. So, Richard, I'm going to keep on coming back. The Lancet Commission should not stop after these rollouts. You talked about independent commission. There should be independent commissions at the country levels, too. So when the head of the state has to be informed about what is the buzzword globally, that's Minister of External Affairs. So that comes to the stakeholders at the national level. So health ministers, obviously, he or she has to deliver. Finance minister, he or she has to budget. Minister of External Affairs, a foreign minister, has to be on the side of the head of the state. This is a valid thing for us to do. Returns of investment are good politically as well as in the context of public health. Political investments are at times as important to individuals as are the public health investments. But if you marry those two, the outcomes are better. And often, at country level, there aren't strong champions. There are champions, they are not strong. So that's where the outsiders sitting in this room and rooms elsewhere, and I'm looking at Asim, he's an excellent champion in Pakistan, they can keep on elevating. I'm reminded by a couple of advisors in India who tell me money comes if you have something that's credible to put in front of the leaders. APLMA has done a beautiful thing, M2030 initiative. Thailand, Indonesia, now going to Japan, going into India, going into Africa. That brings that visibility. But I think commissioners, Richard, should continue their work, engaging with the private sector, because often heads of the states listen to the private sector as much as they listen to their members of the parliament. So I'll just stop there and hopefully engage in some question and answers.
Yep. Thank you, Altaf. I will have one very quick follow-up question to each of the panelists, and then I hope we still have a little bit of time for the audience. I absolutely agree with the conclusion of the commission that eradication of malaria is affordable. I do think the money can be mobilized. The money is there. It is achievable, and it is necessary. Among the big challenges that I think all of us will face is that it's so long-term, and that it's always a challenge to keep a momentum going. And that is the question also then of keeping the political will going. I think, Richard, you alluded to that also in your presentation. I think that will be one of the key challenges. So I have a quick question to each of you from your perspective. Amita, APLMA and APLMA, you're organizing every year senior government official meetings. What would be your brief message? Why should they continue to engage in the long term?
Gosh, I mean, a brief message.
Yes.
So I guess, you know, from the APLMA perspective, you know, the reason malaria elimination is critical is just because of the impact it has on broader health coverage. And, you know, when you look at malaria and the impact it has on mothers and children, on the economy, it has a ripple-on effect which transcends, you know, just the basic cost of malaria elimination. So the bang for the buck is much higher, and the value for money that you get is significantly higher than what you put in just basic malaria service delivery. So I think for me, that would be the one-point message.
Thank you. Jimmy, you're the secretary to the Prime Minister of Solomon Islands, and you've worked with many prime ministers and presidents in the region. What is your one message? Why should a prime minister continue to engage in the malaria eradication effort?
He needs to have a legacy as the prime minister responsible for leading the charge to eradicate malaria, simple as that. But in order to get there, he needs to be like a preacher. And the only people that are passionate about the message you're putting are people that stand on the pulpit. And that's because they internalize, they believe in it. And I think the important thing here for our leaders is not just to say it, yeah. They have to believe in it, they have to live it, yeah. And they have to lead the charge.
Right, great. So we have a cost-benefit effort argument, we have a legacy argument. Robin, in Australia, we need to engage the respective foreign ministers because they are also responsible for the aid budget. What is your message to any kind of Australian foreign minister? Why should they engage? And I know they are very engaged, actually, on the Malaria Council and on other panels. What's the main argument for them?
Yeah, and it's timely because, in a sense, we still have a relatively new minister who is re-engaging on the question of support for malaria elimination and has recently taken up a position on the End Malaria Council. And I guess from our minister's perspective, there's an opportunity and a threat here. The elimination narrative is immensely powerful to a minister who is trying to communicate to the public, to taxpayers, that development assistance resources achieve significant, measurable, visible impacts. So that, you know, the elimination narrative is seen as a huge opportunity by ministers. At the same time, the rise of drug resistance represents a great threat and, in a sense, presents a reputational risk for governments investing in malaria control and elimination. So I think, you know, if you're a politician, both sides of that coin are quite compelling.
Right. It's also kind of like an appeal to the global public good, if you like, the resistance issue, because it goes across borders. Thank you. Altar, among many other things, you know, APLMA has done is also they created the M2030 initiative, you know, engaging with companies, philanthropies in the region to invest more in malaria. What would be your message to a CEO, to a kind of philanthropist? Why should they engage in this effort?
So before I answer that question, I wanted to continue the thought process. I know we're running slightly behind time, with apologies to organizers, but it's I think it's worth going into it. I'm reminded
we have
of
the moderator on the panel, Altaf, so she will interrupt us any time.
I'm reminded of a conversation I had with Tommy Thompson, who was at that point Secretary of Health and Human Services. He had just lost the election and became the HHS Secretary. He came to a visit in India on polio, and then he whispered into my ear, he says, "Now I know why I lost the election." I said, "What do you mean, Governor?" He said, "I never went door-to-door campaigning. Public health is the best political tool to win elections, if politicians are advised and informed." Second piece of that is fundraising and the political profitability of the fundraising is a competitive arena. Without naming countries, if a country A has eliminated malaria in South Asia region, country B doesn't want to be seen left with malaria for a long time because they get told, look, that country and this country has eliminated, so make it a competitive thing. That's for the host nation political discourse internal. Going back to the M2030, I believe that 2 years from now, or 3 years from now, if what Ben and is doing, and what Patrick are doing, and Jeff are doing, if they continue bringing a country every other year or every other 6 months into this fold, it's not critical that they raise millions of dollars. It's country raised in the country for that country. It brings the awareness. That's where the political messages start going out. Money will flow in because the need and the public health cry is going to be so critical. And in certain countries, you still have kind of the founders of the private sector who are making decisions. But in some countries, these are now second generation who are much more vibrant in terms of social awareness, much more connected globally. So different countries may have to be approached differently as Patrick rolls out. And the important thing is now there's an M2030 Africa being discussed.
Yep, thank you. I think this is a great example because as part of the financing, we're not only discussing government financing,
yeah.
We are discussing innovative finance mechanisms, including philanthropy, and there is a lot of momentum and potential in this region, and M2030 is maybe the best example to leverage that momentum. And by the way, I mean, Tommy Thompson might have lost the election as governor of Wisconsin, but then he became the second chair of the Global Fund to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria. I'm sure that was the best job he ever had in his life, talking about legacy. Do we have time for one or two questions from the audience? Dr. Sumi.
Thank you very much for the good presentation. I'm Sumi Manabu, Japanese Minister of Foreign Affairs. My question is to the Dr. Rogers. The Lancet Commission concluded that additional resources is necessary, so I agree with that. But at this moment, there are many competing issues, even among the health issues, such as NCD or the health system strengthening. So my question is that based on your experience working for the Prime Minister, how can you advise us to the appeal to the each country to the allocate more domestic resources to the malaria?
That's a PhD question. To write a thesis on it. No, thank you. So just for the audience, NCDs are responsible for about 70 to 80% of all deaths in all Pacific countries. Yeah, so by virtue of magnitude, obviously, governments would go there. I think the issue with malaria, though, is I think it's a win-win. The resource allocation to NCDs need to increase. However, if we can knock off malaria and don't worry about it anymore, that is also a win. And so the messaging's got to be balanced that whilst you start to look at investing in what the biggest killers are, it's important that you put one of the major killers behind you so you don't have to worry about it anymore. So keep investing. Thank you.
One. Kamini? And that's the last question, I promise.
Two quick comments. First to Amita and Jimmy. I was going to say one of the important sectors in Sri Lanka's effort to eliminate malaria was a very often ignored sector, which is the military. The military, and I think this is so relevant to most countries in this region, they are the ones who are most at risk. The residual burden of malaria tends to reside in the military because they are in the forest, they move around, not only to eliminate malaria, but in the Koreas, it was the military that brought it back after eliminating malaria. So I think that's just a point I want to make. And the other quick comment to Robin. Robin, you'd be surprised that malaria in many countries in this region is fast becoming a health security issue, because in countries that have eliminated malaria, or nearly so, like Bhutan, Sri Lanka, even Timor-Leste, Malaysia, China, budgets for malaria are now going into the health security budget line. And so there is a closer relation, because this is a risk of it coming back. So there is a closer relationship than we think of as malaria as a health security risk.
Thank you very much. Thanks to a great panel. I think none of us here underestimates the challenges, but I also felt that we got a little bit of a sense that, you know, with the leadership from all the sectors represented here on the panel, from a regional organization to a government, to a donor government, to the private sector, with leadership like that, I do think it will be possible and it will be very necessary to achieve the goals we are discussing today. Thank you so much.
take their seats for our last panel discussion of the day. Thank you, everybody. So our last panel is on delivering eradication, strengthening health systems, and leaving no one behind. So our moderator for this session is Dr. Vernon Lee. Dr. Lee is a public health physician with expertise in global health policy and management, infectious diseases epidemiology, preparedness, and research. Among other hats, he also serves as the director for communicable diseases at the Ministry of Health in Singapore. Dr. Lee.
Thank you so much. So this is the last panel, and we'll be talking a little bit about how do we deliver eradication. And this is in the context of looking at how eradicating malaria sits alongside health system strengthening and other activities that goes on in countries. So how do we actually deliver eradication for malaria in an equitable manner? Obviously, we will need lots of resources. And we have already talked a little bit about financing in the earlier session, but we will now look more into how do countries actually finance malaria eradication vis-a-vis other programs that countries have to invest in as well. In addition, we'll also be looking at human resources. How do we ensure that there's sufficient management capabilities? How do we ensure training of field staff? And also importantly, how do we retain these manpower in those countries, knowing that there's usually a lot of what we call brain drain when we train staff and they move on to different sectors or different countries. Also, within health systems, how do we link eradication of malaria to other initiatives such as universal health coverage and health system strengthening, which underpins or is foundation of many programs in these countries? How do we address competing interests? For example, antimicrobial resistance, emerging infectious diseases, and other vector-borne diseases such as dengue has seen a lot of resurgence in many regional countries and are the focus of regional governments as well. How do we avoid overlaps and duplication and increase efficiencies? For example, when we perform dengue control or dengue control programs, can we synchronize malaria eradication programs with dengue control programs so that we can use the same workers to effect the same outcomes without having too much duplication? And finally, how about IT and data management, given that there's a lot of big data and information technologies that are available in regional countries? How do we use all this data that's available to increase the effectiveness of malaria eradication programs? So today we have three panelists. The first, Professor Neelam Shikri Feacham, who is an associate professor at the Institute for Global Health Sciences at the University of California, San Francisco. And she's an expert in comparative health systems and also a commissioner in the Lancet report. Next, we have Dr. Rose Nadimuddin, who is a public health physician and head of the Vector-Borne Diseases Program in Malaysia's Ministry of Health. And she presided over the program in Malaysia where the country reported zero human cases of falciparum and vivax malaria. And finally, Ms. Sandy Luin, from Myanmar, and she's the founder and managing director at the Myanmar Health and Development Consortium, having previously worked for the Global Fund, the World Bank, IMF, UNDP, among others. And she currently sits on a high-level task force on health financing in Myanmar.
So, without much further ado, maybe I'll turn the floor to Professor Neelam to maybe talk a little bit about the specifics on how malaria eradication actually links with other country initiatives such as universal health coverage, health system strengthening, and also in the sort of competing world for the same amount of resources.
Please. Thank you very much. I think actually the last panel and many of the other panelists have touched on this issue quite a bit. And I have to say they've done my job for me, so hopefully I'll be much quicker than I would have otherwise been. I was at WHO in health systems and health financing when what was at that point an upstart called the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria started to pour billions and billions of dollars into three diseases. And one of our biggest concerns at WHO, because of course we always have concerns, was how this amount of money was going to distort health systems and health priorities on the ground. So my role in this commission was to look at how the goal of malaria eradication could either help or hinder the other broader health and development goals, like universal health coverage and health system strengthening, health security, and other very, very important goals that all countries have to deal with. And what we found in the commission is that there's a particularly strong opportunity for synergies, as you said, Professor, in terms of how do you use human resources and financial resources to be able to deal with a variety of health systems issues. And that malaria eradication, and in particular universal health coverage, can be mutually reinforcing. But it won't happen by accident. It has to be done consciously. And I'm going to highlight three areas where I think we have to be very, very conscious and deliberate in how we approach those two goals. The first has been mentioned many times, and that is strong, effective, adaptable, data-driven management. The weak management is the single biggest constraint to failing to achieve malaria eradication and failing to achieve UHC. We need strong management. And that management has to be both of malaria programs and health systems. And the interesting thing, when you look at both of these goals, the end game, kind of the last mile for both areas, is bringing access to isolated, vulnerable, hard-to-reach communities. And I think that program managers from both health systems and malaria programs can work together and need to work together in a coordinated approach to approach these communities, to understand the needs of these communities, and to not just provide, okay, well, now we're going to give you the bed net. Now we're going to give you this vaccine. Now we're going to do this. But we're actually going to give you an integrated health set of primary care services that will help you to meet the health needs of your community. And along with that, we need to build multivalent integrated infrastructure. And that's at the human level, the technical level, the technological level, as you mentioned, IT, and physically. It's already happening now with the Global Fund having it really broadened its funding to health systems, which is great news. But staff, supply chains, lab facilities, diagnostic tools, they need to be able to treat a wide range of diseases that affect communities. So that community health workers should not just know how to identify malaria and treat malaria, but they should know how to distinguish malaria from other febrile diseases that may be more common as the burden of malaria goes down, like dengue, and have the appropriate tools to treat all of those diseases effectively. And that's got to be true at the primary care level and also at the district hospital level. And then the third area, which I think Altaf touched on, but I really want to come back to, is private providers particularly. It may be surprising to some people that most people in the world get their health care through private providers. And in some countries, like my country, India, or my country, the US, the private sector is also the one that diagnoses and often misdiagnoses and treats and often mistreats malaria cases. And in very few instances, in India, for example, are malaria cases reported to the public authorities. So we don't even have a number about how many malaria cases there are because of the strong involvement of the private sector. So for malaria eradication and for achieving UHC, we need to co-opt the private provider sector. And we need to make sure that they're serving the public interest. and that they are coming under the general stewardship of the public sector. Now, that doesn't mean ownership or management or control, but that they're meeting, they're under the same set of regulations, the same set of quality standards. And I think Singapore has a lot to teach us because it has done a fantastic job of creating a level playing field between public and private providers. So I'll stop there and turn it over to my colleague.
Well, thank you for your comments, Professor. So I think you've given us very good insights onto need for integration of different programs, the need to build collective capabilities, especially at the primary care, but also at the secondary and tertiary care levels, and working across sectors, so be it private sector, or earlier someone was talking about the military and other sectors. They should all come together because everyone has some skills and best practices to bring to the table. So maybe next we can ask Dr. Rose, what is your experience in the Malaysia's journey to zero malaria, and what are the lessons that you would have for the region, especially integrating all of these practices in that last mile or the last push?
Yeah, thank you, Prof. Lee. Actually, Malaria Control Program, Malaria Control Program in Malaysia has a long history, and we started as early as in 1970s with the Eradication Program, where we managed to bring down cases from 240,000 to about 44,000 in 1980s. And then in 2011, we started to engage our program with the elimination program. And at that time, we were having about 4,000 cases. And when we review our resources, that we are capable of going into the elimination phase. And when we started with these eliminations, I think for you to implement the elimination program, first you must get a political commitment and support. This is very important for you to get financial support, resources available at any time if you request from your ministry or from your government. And at that time, you also have to educate your staff from the top level. You have to educate your bosses. You have to educate your technical staff and also the ground staff, so that they know what is elimination about. So you must have one goal for all, from the top level to the from the implementers, so that you can have the same strategies and same methods and goals. And we apply about eight main strategies that is very important after reviewing our country capability and what is the shortfall in our country. You need to do situational analysis before you go to these eliminations, so that you know where is the loophole that you need to cover and where are the area that you need to improve. But as a program manager, I agree with you, Prof, because you need to be you need to have a innovative and creative program manager. You have, because disease transmission is dynamic, and you cannot use that like 2011 technique until 2019. Along these 9 years, you have to change according to your country situations. And we use a strategy, for example, the most important is we have a strong malaria surveillance. We have a real-time web-based surveillance system from the district level to the national level. You can see any data within few seconds they enter at the district to the top-level management. Mm-hmm. So if your bosses want to look at your situation, they can just open and get their password and look at what you have done. So the other thing is this surveillance also must be able to get early detection of your cases, good coverage and early detection. And we have also a strong malaria case management. We have a standardized guidelines for managing malaria, including public and private sectors. And we also establish our prevention of reintroduction guidelines along the way. And we also engage the community and the private sector in our in our program, because you need them to help you to detect and also to give you information about malaria in their area. And we have a public health intelligence from the community. Mm-hmm. So they become our investigator. They will tell us, oh, there's a newcomer there that you need to screen. So we will go in do our prevention activity. And we also engage our institutions to do research. For example, when we had a PK, P. nolosi problem, we engage our Institute of Malaria, Institute of Research of Malaysia, where they did a study on how to reduce the anopheles mosquitoes in that particular in the affected area. So now we already implement what they have done. The study has come out with a good result, so we implement that in our program. A part of that capacity building is important, because once you reach the eliminations, you need the feeling of complacency is there by your staff, and you have to manage, sustain your budget from your top level, from your political ministers and deputy ministers and your director general. And you have to also build capacity, especially your microscopists, your doctors in diagnosing malaria, and so that you have to work in a team. So in our team, we have a health education officer, we have a clinician, we have a parasitologist, we have a public health specialist. We work in a team. So our champion is a team. So that's how we conduct in Malaysia.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rose. I think she has touched on some very important points, which echoes what Professor Neelam had said earlier. So I think certainly one, political commitment and support, that's really important. Without that, I think none of these programs would actually take off. The other point about engaging and educating stakeholders, very important, so that they are on your side and not against you, you're working with you. Also adjusting for dynamic changes, both in the disease or in your country programs. I think these are important so that your program is a live program and can be, you know, adjusted to suit the changing dynamics of the sort of current situation. And finally, I think you brought up a very good point about the need for sustainability. A lot of times when we reach zero, it's very easy to fall into sort of a lull or to be complacent, and you need to be able to sustain that. So I think that's those are very important points. So thank you so much. So finally, we have Ms. Sandy, who will talk a little bit about sustainable financing in the Myanmar context, and what are the challenges and opportunities when we look about financing malaria elimination versus other programs.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Lee, for the introduction. I wanted to provide perhaps a brief overview of the malaria situation as well as recent health and financing reforms in the country, and also maybe highlight some of the issues mentioned in the Commission's report, specifically around management and operations and alignment with the broader health and development goals. As many of you know, malaria is still a major public health issue in the country as well as in the region. So we account for about 56% of all reported cases in the Greater Mekong Sat region. However, with the support from partners, the country has made remarkable progress in recent years towards malaria elimination. In just 6 years, the number of reported malaria cases has dropped by 86% across the country. In terms of alignment with SDGs, the government has outlined in its National Health Plan 2017 to 2021 the foundations for achieving universal health coverage and rolling out essential package of health services for the entire population without having to endure financial hardships. As Sir Richard has said earlier, out-of-pocket expenditure is also quite high at 76 or 78%. In order to achieve this, a health financing strategy was developed recently to include fiscal space analysis, risk pooling, and purchasing policy options, and a legal framework for health financing reform towards universal health coverage. As we speak, there's a draft UHC law that's sitting in Parliament, and that will be finalized soon. Most notably, though, the purchasing policy option articulates the formation of an autonomous purchasing entity for strategic purchasing from any accredited partner. So whether it's from the public sector or private provider, ethnic health organizations or NGOs. In terms of management and operations, Myanmar has also made policy changes for better integration and prioritization of human resources. For example, village malaria volunteers have been renamed Integrated Community Malaria Volunteers, or ICMVs. There have been a total of 18,000 volunteers that's been trained to address other diseases, including for TB, HIV, leprosy, dengue, and filariasis. Briefly, also on surveillance, Dr. Gauchi mentioned the 137 approach, and Myanmar has also started the case and foci investigation, classification and response in 211 of the 333 townships. We're also leveraging on private sector involvement through initiatives such as M2030 that was mentioned earlier, working with corporate champions from the financial sector, infrastructure, private hospital, retail and consumer sectors to raise funds, increase awareness and support malaria program implementation. Similarly, under the Global Fund Regional Malaria Grant, the Union of Myanmar Chambers of Commerce is leveraging on private-public partnerships to harness the latest technologies and innovative approaches of the private sector. Some of the examples are mobiles for malaria, for real-time foci investigation, case reporting and stock management, digital wallet for cash transfers, and fast-moving consumer goods to improve supply chain management. So having said all this, Myanmar's malaria situation is not without its challenges. It is complex. We are faced with multi-drug resistance, access to remote areas, movement of populations, and so on. But we hope that the measures that are being put in place now reflect the recommendations of the Commission's report, including around management, engagement of private and corporate sectors, regulatory and financial reforms for equitable health access to health services as part of the UHC agenda, are all the right measures that are being put in place towards achieving the end game for malaria. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. So I think the same themes have recurred. I think it's really important, as you've mentioned, to adopt UHC and health system strengthening as the foundation, not just for malaria elimination programs, but for all programs so that the sort of funding and resourcing are synchronized across these platforms. You also mentioned you need to have financial and program reform so that they are sustainable to prevent hardship in any sort of program. And you don't want the different programs to sort of cannibalize against each other. Mm-hmm. So I think you've really provided us with a very good framework that Myanmar has used to support this. So maybe in the interest of time, I'll open to the floor for maybe a couple of comments, and then we can have a further discussion with the panel on this issue of synchronizing malaria eradication with health systems and equitable distribution as well. So anyone on the floor would like to ask any questions? Yes, please, a couple of people there. Okay, maybe three questions. The lady, the gentleman over the back, and the gentleman in front.
Hi, Dr. Rose. This is Kelly Harvard from UCSF. I was wondering if you could speak to what the Malaysian program did to identify, target, and tailor interventions to your last mile populations, which is something other countries in the region are struggling to do.
Yes, we have. In our country, actually, we had a committee which consists of public health physicians, like I've mentioned, and parasitologists, clinicians, and also from the state and the district officers. So from this committee, we will discuss on, we will look at, we do, we did a situational analysis, and we look at what will be the target for this particular state and district, because they are we have 15 states, and each of these states are not similar. They are different. Some states have this hotspot area for malaria. Some states they don't have malaria cases at all, and some cases are moderately having cases on and off during the year. So this need to be tailored according to the area and the situations. And after doing that, you need to have a workshop and sit with them and have the targets. But you must inline your target with the global target. For example, the WHO target or the APLMA or APLMA target, because you need to compare your country with other country. So you have to have orange and orange comparisons, not orange and apple comparisons. So at the end of the day, after we come into consensus that this is applicable and can be done with the resources that we have, then we will conduct that methods or mechanism. If, for example, they do not have the resources that they need our help to get these resources from the top level, we will do a paperwork and give that to our top level for their approval and to support us the resources. I think that is the mechanism that we are applying in our country.
Thank you so much. Well, while we're on this topic of trying to get sufficient resources, and we know that resources are always limited, especially if you're trying to obtain them from the same sources.
Yes.
Do the panelists have any comments about how we can reach out to different sectors? I know, for example, Professor Neelam, you had mentioned about bringing together different stakeholders from, for example, the private sector. Do you have any sort of tips for us? How do we bring different sectors to the table to talk about a common issue such as malaria eradication?
I mean, I think Myanmar seems to have done it.
Well, I think it's starting to gain momentum, but I would say that there was a lot of private sector engagement a few years ago, particularly with the oil and gas sector and the foundations associated with it. But the issue is that in these sectors, they are not seeing malaria cases anymore. So it's no longer a corporate priority for many of the corporations, and it's a bit difficult now, particularly when you're not seeing the cases, to convince them that this is actually a very important agenda. So I think there needs to be more advocacy, and I think corporate champions are the best place to do this, but we do need to get the larger corporate involved in terms of sustaining the engagement.
Sure. Thank you, Ms. Sandy. Professor Neelam?
I mean, I don't think when we talk about financing, we shouldn't limit ourselves to just people who are providing money or giving philanthropy. But in many, many countries, we have large faith-based organizations, a huge sector that's actually delivering care, diagnosing malaria, providing health resources and health system services. I mean, they are part of the solution, and they're contributing quite a bit. And I don't know, I think some countries do a good job of quantifying and bringing them into the overall malaria control strategy, and some countries could do a much better job of doing that. So I think there's providers that are already involved in this that can be brought under the fold of malaria control programs and this vision of eradication.
Sure. That's very astute comments, indeed. I think also not to forget the community itself. Yeah. There are many sort of community-based organizations and structures that can be tapped upon as well.
Yes.
Maybe the gentleman?
Yes.
Thank you. My name is Suli Panu Wong from United States from Kopier. So I just would like to ask the panelists to comment on engaging the regulatory of each of the country or regional level or global level to look into the quality, efficacy, and safety of the anti-malaria in the context of malaria. You know, the lesson that we learned in the greater Mekong sub-region, starting from 2003 up to 2013, when the funding from the external partners came into the region, then every country was focusing on looking at the quality of the anti-malarials. Some statistics, just to share with you, 2004, 2005, for example, up to 35%, some country 50% of the product do not meet the quality specifications. Over the years, after the effort of some of the countries and donors, by 2015, that failure rate reduced to less than 5%, some country even 1%. To our surprise, by 2016-17, based on the random sampling of 4 countries in the greater Mekong subregion, the failure rate reached 30% of anti-malarials in the region. So, can you speak a little bit on how to engage the regulatory setting to support the disease program to me? Thank you.
Anyone wants to comment on that? Regulatory systems?
In Malaysia, we get full support from our Ministry of Health, so we don't have a global fund support or financial support. But we do have to do our quality control and quality assessment for example, every single cent that's spent in your program, what will be the outcome? So we as a program manager, for example, we will commit that our outcome will be zero human indigenous. Of course, I will respond on Prof. Barbier's comment after this. So when we have this KPI, we have a key performance indicator. So this performance indicator must be, for example, at one time, our director general is also having that key performance indicator. So each of us will try very hard with using that amount, limited amount of money to achieve our key performance indicator. And we are using integrated management, which we involve the army, for example, the private sector, so giving nets and do IRS spray for their workers' house or to give ITNs to their workers. So they provide that equipment to their workers. And the army, for example, if they are going abroad to the endemic country, they will provide, they just get our advice, what will be the equipment that they need, what could be the prophylaxis that they need, and they will buy on their own. So this is how we work in our country. We have an integrated management, and this also apply to in our dengue management. That's why for this year, for example, most of the country had increased 1 to 8 times of dengue cases in their country. In our country, 85%, because 7 ministries are doing the same work as we do, sure, to prevent dengue. Yeah. So this mechanism we apply also in malaria.
Okay, thank you so much. Yes,
so let me respond to the regulatory question in 2 ways. On one side, we have regulatory approval mechanisms that are duplicative, that are time-consuming, you get FDA approval, but you also then need WHO approval, and then you need the country approval, and then you need, they're long, drawn-out mechanisms that prevent new drugs and tools getting to the market. On the other hand, you don't have enough resources for post-regulatory approval monitoring for quality, to ensure that once a drug has been approved, that the manufacturer of that drug is meeting requirements. And we've seen some spectacular failures, especially with generics, in not meeting those requirements. So, I think that the regulatory structures need to be revamped completely. And I think we need to stop a lot of the resources that we're putting into the duplication of preventing drugs getting on the market need to be rechanneled into post regulatory quality control. And it may be that there needs to be roles, different roles for different actors. For example, you know, that at the global level, you have the regulatory mechanisms that for approvals, and then the country level focuses on the post-regulatory approval monitoring and quality control. So I don't know what the true answer to that is, but I just think it needs a major overhaul.
Sure. And this would be applicable not just for malaria, anti-malarials, but
yes,
across
everything.
All yeah. Sort of drug and pharmaceuticals.
Yeah.
I'm mindful that we have exceeded time by about 5 minutes, so I don't want to hold up the program too long. Perhaps if you have a question, you can approach the panel later, or you have a very quick comment.
Very quick question.
Sure.
Question isn't to the panel, but to the two fine individuals sitting on my left. China and Sri Lanka. So they eliminated. Did they have functional universal health system, mm-hmm. or did they have effective healthcare system? So in some states of India, Neelam, you know this, some states have better health indices. Their immunization rates are good. The nutrition rates are good, and their malaria incidence is down as well. So if Kamini, you and Gauchi could share with us what was present when you started elimination.
Okay, can so, I just yeah. make one comment on that? I don't think that you need, I mean, I know you don't need universal health coverage to achieve malaria eradication. Absolutely, most countries in the world have achieved malaria elimination without universal health coverage. All of Europe did it. The United States did it. I mean, you know, now Sri Lanka has done it. China is closer to universal health coverage than many other countries. So I don't think it's a necessary prerequisite, but I do think that they're mutually reinforcing. Mm-hmm. That once you have achieved malaria elimination, then you have built some of that infrastructure that then you can build your foundation of UHC on. So that's what I would say the message is. And I'm please, Kevin.
Yeah.
Quick
response. Maybe just a very quick 15 seconds, and then we have to move on to program.
So very bland response.
Sure.
Sri Lanka had a very good health system. Nobody, there were no special volunteer workers for malaria. Malaria just plugged into the excellent health system. Immunization coverage is good. Anyone can get health care within half an hour of being sick. Transport systems are excellent and so on. But Neelam will find it very interesting. It is said, although I don't know, I've never sort of been there to see it. It is said that this excellent health system was built on the grounds of the 1960s malaria eradication program, which really built outreach clinics to address malaria, and that this was built on the grounds, on that foundation. So as you said, Neelam, it's both ways, and I'll tough. That,
sure.
That's my reason.
So there are synergies, and they can build
absolutely.
On each other.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Do you want to say something quickly?
Okay, yeah. So I believe the health systems, especially in the low level, the basic level, is important for malaria elimination. However, we didn't want to rebuild the new systems. So the question is, many things they talk about China have a very good systems, but I already tell you, we have many of the private sections, especially in the village level. So the challenge is how to link this private section involved our malaria elimination systems. So this will be we planning to malaria elimination program, we do not forget them. So how to make the reasonable mechanism let them can involve our malaria elimination activity. This can save the money and save the time.
Okay, well thank you so much. So no system is perfect, but we can work together across stakeholders to make it better and to strengthen it. So
great.
Thank you so much to the panel. Well, thank you.
Well, thank you, Amita. I stand between you and a glass of wine, and I also stand between you and a much more interesting discussion in small groups in the adjoining room. So I'm going to be very brief, and I'm certainly not going to attempt to sum up the very rich discussion we've had this afternoon. I want to make just a few comments under the heading, What Next? And then a few comments under the heading, Appreciation. So, what next? I've been asked several times today, what will the Commission do now? You've published your report, so what happens in the next months and the next years? And let me try and give a very preliminary answer to that, and your ideas on that question would be of great interest to us. So we'd like to know what you think about the what next question. But I can mention a few things that are either underway or in mind. Firstly, we are on a roadshow. So we're taking the Commission report around the world very deliberately. This is the event number 6. It's actually the second event in Asia Pacific because ALTAF led an event in India 10 days ago or so. And we're continuing. There are many more planned around the world where the Commission's findings can be discussed, debated, argued about, contradicted, disagreed with. We can stimulate that intellectual debate that we need to have. And I'd like to very much call on you in this regard. If you know of upcoming conferences, meetings, policy discussions where you think the work of the Commission is relevant, let us know. I do not promise that I will get on a plane and come. Neelam certainly will. And other commissioners, we may be able to mobilize some of our 26 commissioners to come and join that event. We can certainly provide you with lots of copies of the report and support you in other ways. But a very serious request from me to everyone, if you can think of opportunities that are relevant, be they in Pakistan or in Australia or wherever, do let us know, and we will support to the fullest of our ability, and we'd like to hear back from you about what debate took place and what conclusions were reached. A second possible next step is to have a regional look or a sub-regional look at some of the analyses and some of the findings of the Commission. Let me just give a couple of examples. The Commission did some detailed financial analysis, by far the most detailed malaria financing analysis yet conducted. And you'll find that in the report and in the long technical annex to the report, which many of you probably have not yet looked at. Those analyses are either for the 106 countries that had malaria in the year 2000, or for the 86 countries that had malaria in 2017. There's a regional version of that analysis, or a sub-regional version of that analysis, which would show a very different picture and be instructive and interesting and useful. Even a country version of that analysis could very well inform government thinking and policy thinking about how do we finance our road to elimination. What is coming from OOPS today? Is it too high? What will I do about it? What's coming from the government today? Is that too stingy? Could that be reasonably increased? Have I got a case to bring to the Minister of Finance? What is coming from international sources today? The Global Fund, are they about to cut me off? Because they're cutting off a lot of countries. They're graduating or transitioning countries out of eligibility for Global Fund money. So those kind of debates, based on the kind of analysis we did globally, could be very useful. Those analyses could be very useful regionally, sub-regionally, and country by country. So we hope to see some of that. Another example of a less analytical nature, we make strong recommendations about management, management training, data for better management. But the reality of that is very different. If you talk about local level management in Zimbabwe and local level management in Myanmar and local level management in the Solomon Islands, you're having three very different discussions in very different contexts. So further work that draws out the specificity and moves away from the generalizations that are inevitably contained in the Commission's report, I feel will be very useful. And do let us know if you have ideas for that, and we will try to support. A third heading under What Next is to encourage and to track the recommendations of the Commission being actually adopted in practice. Some countries in this room already do most of what the Commission recommends. Some countries in this room don't do a number of things that the Commission recommends. So we'd like to see those debates, we'd like to see the recommendations taken up or deliberately rejected if they are not applicable in a particular situation, and then to track the impact of those policy innovations, practice innovations, to see what results from that. And then lastly, there is a growing suggestion that we should convert the Lancet Commission into a standing commission. So the Lancet Commission for Malaria Eradication under that scenario would become an ongoing group of 20 women and men from around the world who would meet once a year, and the Lancet has already made clear that they would publish an annual, probably on April the 25th every year, they would publish an annual update. Where have we got to on the various factors that the Commission drilled into? And each year's publication might have a broad overview, but also might have a more detailed drill down in certain specific areas. What's happening with monoclonal antibodies, or what's happening with management training, or what's happening with increased government expenditure. One could take one of a number of particular issues taken up by the Commission and give a more detailed analysis of that on an annual basis. So that's a thought. And again, if you have views on that, do write to us and let us know what they are. And if you'd be keen to participate in that, please do let us know. Moving on then to my heading of appreciation, the thank yous, which are very heartfelt from me and my colleagues from San Francisco. Firstly, a big thank you to our co-hosts, APLMA, APMEN, and the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy at the National University of Singapore. Thank you. We are a small team located in the People's Democratic Republic of California. We could not have remotely had any chance of organizing this event and bringing people from around the region had we not had the partnership with APLMA, APMEN, and the National University. So a big appreciation to our co-hosts and co-sponsors. Secondly, the Commission and this meeting and things that will follow are only possible through the generosity of Bill and Melinda Gates. It is the Gates Foundation that paid for the Commission. It is the Gates Foundation that has paid for the follow-up to the publication of the Commission. And without the generous support and engagement of the Gates Foundation, we couldn't be doing any of this. And I don't know whether our colleagues from the Gates Foundation are still with us or have left. They are still with us, but they're hiding behind the pillar. So, Krishan, thank you, and thank you to the team back home in Seattle. This would not have been possible without you. Thirdly, I think I join you all in thanking Dr. Balakrishnan for joining us at the beginning of the meeting. I think it's exceptional to have a foreign minister come and be so engaged and so articulate about a health topic, not just health, but one disease, and some ambitious plans to eradicate that disease. Special thank you to Dr. Balakrishnan. And then lastly, and I think most importantly, to all of you firstly, just for coming, for being here, for engaging, and in some cases for traveling a long distance, but more especially for your work, for your ambition, for your vision, and for your achievements. It is your achievements in this region, more than anything else, that I think put us in the position that Christoph spoke about, the position to be sitting here together in 2019, seriously discussing the end of malaria on our planet. A remarkable thing that those of us who were trained 40, 50 years ago would never have dreamt would have become a serious discussion in our lifetime. And the fact that it is a serious discussion, and the fact that the 41 authors of the Commission report believe that it can be done by 2050 if we choose to do it, doesn't mean it will be done, but we believe it can be done, and we urge that it should be done. The fact that this is our conclusion and that we are gathered here in large measure of agreement with that conclusion is, I think, due to the achievements of countries around the world and in Asia Pacific more than anywhere else. And we've mentioned quite a bit the recent spectacular achievements of Timor-Leste, of Malaysia, of Sri Lanka, of China. But I want to just quickly read the list of countries that may well have eliminated by 2025, which is just around the corner. And they include Bhutan, Bangladesh, Nepal, North Korea, Philippines, South Korea, Thailand, Vanuatu, and Vietnam. All that may not happen, but it's all plausible. It could happen by 2025, and I've no doubt that some of it will happen. And finally, to close, can those under 60 years of age raise their hands, please? Okay, almost everyone. So, malaria elimination across Asia Pacific in your professional lifetime. In your professional lifetime, no more malaria across Asia Pacific. That's almost all of you. Now, those under 40 years of age, raise their hands. Yes. So, a third of you. No more malaria on the planet in your professional lifetimes. Let's make sure we do it. Thank you very much. Wine away.